Thank you. So now we are audible. Hi everyone, can you hear us? Can you see us? Let me edit the camera setup so it's a little more functional. Hi there everyone, it's so great to be with you all. I have an amazing special guest today. I'll introduce him in just a moment. Okay, so there's that. And then we'll go here. Let me get chat working as well. Can everyone hear us? So it's great to be here with everybody. Today we have an amazing special guest. This is Dr. James Thomas. He is a otolaryngologist, a world-renowned voice surgeon. He has developed many voice gender-affirming vocal surgery techniques. He has helped so many people in our community correct revisions and sort of botched issues with other vocal surgeries or tracheal shaves. I would consider him to be the most knowledgeable person in the world about vocal gender-affirming surgery. So it's a super big honor to have him here. And yeah, so everyone say hi to him. I don't know if you want a link so you can see the chat, I'll post that. Here's a link in the Zoom in case you want to take a look at the chat. But yes, everyone, give a warm welcome to Dr. James Thomas. I'm going to get the, let me get the chat pulled up here as well so it's more functional. Display capture. This should be a screen. Okay, so I'm either going to make a mistake or I'm not. I hope this is the right screen. If it's not, then I made a mistake. Let's see. Okay, wrong one. Let me go ahead and close that. Okay. You see how many messages I'm floating? It's not very good. Okay, so there we go. So there's that, and then I'll take this over here and get the chat all pulled up for us, and then we can begin. I was trying to do the chat stuff with the stream element stuff, folks, but I wasn't able to figure that out very well, so I'll just do a sort of mutated chat down here in the corner. Sorry about that. Okay, so I think we're good. So yeah, so the first thing I kind of want to ask, can you tell us a little bit about your background, how you got into otolaryngology or voice related work in general?
Sure. I got into otolaryngology because the otolaryngologist I've met had fun in the office every day. So it seemed like it was a good profession. And it fit with my background in enjoying science. And so I kind of went straight through Penn State Medical School, undergraduate medical school, and 6 years of training in ENT. And at the end of that, I thought I would like ear stuff because I like music a lot. I did some research on kitten ears and gerbil ears.
That's awesome, cool.
Yeah, I made gerbils dizzy, but I don't know how good that was.
Whoa, was that like some cochlear, like manipulation
stuff? Yeah, like
stuff?
Put little stuff in there and make them dizzy. But then when I went out to practice, I wanted to live on the West Coast. I came out to Portland where I reside now. Mm-hmm. And kind of felt like I opened up a general ENT practice, felt like I couldn't keep up with everything. Medicine keeps advancing, science keeps advancing. And I was getting less good at each little thing I was trying to do. So I decided to focus again because, I mean, there's people in the world who are great generalists. They make great family doctors. They like to do everything, maybe not well, but they love the breadth of it. And I like a focus. So even ENT wasn't focused enough for me. Mm-hmm. And I decided there's this new thing. By new, I mean, there was this new equipment that came out that lets you get inside and see more, and new equipment to watch the vocal cords moving, this strobe light that was coming out. And I
you were practicing before the stroboscopic examination was even really like a thing.
Yeah, I mean, well, there was a strobe light in the 1890s, but it was a spinning wheel and people, it wasn't very practical. And it was this new strobe that was smaller and better and brighter that came out. And I saw that at a meeting and bought it, and it was a lot of money. Most things in medicine are, so it's a lot of money to get it. And once you get it, then you want to use it. Mm-hmm. So one was I wanted to be a specialist. Two was I enjoyed knowing super specialty things. Mm-hmm. Three, this new equipment came out. Four, I paid for it. Five, it was voice, and I like music and sound. And although I wasn't doing ear much, I thought, well, this is also sound. And when I thought back to high school where I loved physics, really the vocal cords are all about physics and sound. I see like in your studio, all the piano and sound equipment. So if you like it,
I can't get enough of it. I love sound so much. I think it's one of the most profound things. And I think, you know, one of the things that I really admire about your work is your emphasis on listening, right?
Yeah.
I think that so many professionals in this space, whether they're medical or speech pathologists, like, they sort of allow listening to kind of take a backseat, and they instead rely on, you know, visual metrics, like in terms of like acoustic measurements or whatever. And I think that those have a place and they're very important, but the ear is the most sensitive listening device that we have. It's the only real listening device that we have. So when did you first start working with the trans population? When did you first start coming across individuals who were seeking gender-affirming care through your services?
Well, you and perhaps some of your audience may know a physician, Toby Meltzer, who was a plastic surgeon in Portland and doing a lot of gender work. And he asked if I would come help out with the voice on some of his patients.
Gotcha.
So that was really my introduction to this subspecialty area.
And what was the first kind of gender affirming care that you were doing? Was it like glottoplasty stuff? Was it tracheal shave?
So he was doing, along with another doctor here, another ENT doc in town, they were doing cricothyroid approximations, mm-hmm. and they weren't having great success at it.
Yeah.
And so they said, could I come do them? And I learned them just mm-hmm. by doing them with them. It really is quite an easy surgery to do,
mm-hmm.
but the outcome doesn't have anything to do with the ease of surgery.
Right.
I started doing them, and I had done about, I don't know, somewhere between 10 and 20 with Toby, and I was noticing there was this several problems with it.
Mm-hmm.
And at that point, he was like happy to have me just deal with all that.
Gotcha.
And so I started doing them on my own and trying to troubleshoot, why isn't this working mm-hmm. the way people think it should?
And I think I would love to get into that with you. I think the first kind of general topic I'd like to talk about in terms of like surgery related stuff is tracheal shave, because I think that that's probably the most common sort of laryngeally related surgery that our community tends to get. And you know, I've noticed a pattern in my students. At this point, I've worked with thousands of people, and I've noticed a very significant pattern in complications and vocal impairment from tracheal shave. And I made a video on this a couple months ago, and I put out a public survey. You know, it wasn't like a clinical, it wasn't like a super rigid survey, but I put out a general survey, and out of 140 people, you know, about 30% of them indicated that they had some significant long-term impairment of their voice. And so I'm just curious, you know, when I try to identify the various risks, we'll get into that actually. Can you tell us a little bit about the tracheal shave procedure and what that entails?
Well, I think your survey is great because I don't even have a sense of what the injury rate is.
Oh, okay.
Because the people I see are the people who have injuries. So everybody who comes to me, you know,
yeah,
with that,
yeah.
you know, has a problem. So I get a very biased view on it. And I do expect it's much higher than most physicians think or even lead their patients to believe.
I saw in the literature, I think it was not Dr. Zukowski, there was a different Dr. Spiegel. I mean, he has two articles published that say, you know, the risks are like negligible 1%, or he said in one study that he did of 140 patients, not a single person had vocal impairment. But if you go and you look at the questionnaire that was asked, there's no identifying question about impairment at all. So, you know, it creates this narrative in the community. And, you know, when I'm looking in the trans spaces, I see so many girls, especially in our community, they're like, oh yeah, doll, just go get tracheal shave, like there's zero risks, like it's such a simple procedure. But then I see so many people who are impaired. You know, one of them really broke my heart a couple months ago, which is what prompted me to kind of talk about this, where I had this amazing voice student who had done great work, and they decided to get a tracheal shave, and they couldn't even, you know, they had two or three semitones worth of range, tremendous air leak, and I actually referred them to you for further examination. So maybe they ended up working with you. But so can you tell us about the procedure and what it entails and why there might be risks associated with it?
Yeah, I guess I should have prepared and had some pictures, although they're medical pictures.
Well, but we can add them in post if you want to send them.
Sure. So I mean, when someone has this problem and they come to me,
this problem
right here where you got this taken off and it's not visible anymore, but the vocal cords have come loose and detached. So the vocal cords are like, they're tight, and the front is the V. And when, if you shave off the attachment, mm-hmm. they just like a guitar string, they go and they droop.
And that's the anterior commissured attachment, right?
That's what that is, yes. Okay. And in my Adam's apple, my thyroid cartilage to be exact, is about 25 millimeters tall. So about an inch tall here, let's say. And the vocal cords attach just below the middle part of that. And so when a surgeon is working on you to take off that bump, if they go below the point where they're starting at the top and they shave down, down, down. And I guess I should say they're not shaving the trachea, which is down here, but everyone calls it the trach shave. And then you want your patient to be, maybe they want to think they want the patient to be happy. So they go a little further to get a little more off and they've just gone too far.
So it's and a matter. So it's a matter of how much you shave vertically down. And do you shave it vertically when you do it?
Yeah, well, to give you a reference how I do it, so I do it a little more involved than other people because I put a camera in, and when I look at and I've opened the skin up, and now I see the cartilage right here.
Yeah.
I put a needle through it, and poke the needle in until I see that the needle and the vocal cords are in the same spot, and now I can take off everything above that quite safely, and I know I won't detach the vocal cords. And that is not the typical technique. I think people who have it might have it from a incision up here where the surgeon can't see it. They're shaving blindly. I think there's a new technique to go in the mouth and down. And if the surgeon isn't looking at this directly, then it's a guess, which the guess might be good or the guess might not be good. I mean, so.
Now, could you use some sort of imaging in order to make that, you know, a safer process other than, I like the needle suggestion that you're making. And I think that, I think it would be great if you could maybe, you know, convey that to other vocal surgeons. Cause I do, I have noticed, I haven't sifted through all the research I collected, but out of 140 sample size, your name has came up the least in terms of tracheal shave damage relative to other individuals who have performed tracheal shaves. So I can pretty much identify some basic trends in surgeons that tend to botch it a little bit more or a little bit less. And so is there a way that maybe we could get other surgeons on board with that? Because it's crazy the persistence of impairment that I see in the population getting that surgery.
I think it's a yes and a no. For instance, I think down in Sao Paulo, Buenos Aires at WPATH about 4 or 5 years ago, maybe your audience is familiar with WPATH, the gathering of surgeons and patients and all kinds of caregivers. And I talked to the surgeons about this technique of putting it in and showed videos of how to do it. But one, many of the people doing it are not ENT surgeons, so they're not familiar with putting a camera in the nose or they don't have one.
Got you, yeah.
And even if somebody has one, they aren't typically doing that. They're doing facial things. And so they, this seems so easy because it's sitting right here. You can pick it off.
Yeah.
And so it has been discussed at least that one time among a group of probably many of the people you know.
Yeah.
Maybe more will come and maybe more people will do it. But I think most patients seem, before surgery, concerned about a scar. They don't want a scar here.
Yeah,
so I must admit that the disadvantage to my technique is I see it. I really won't detach your vocal cords, but I'm putting
you
a scar.
You will leave a scar.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
So there's pros and cons to it. I think the other way is that I tell other surgeons now is the vocal cords typically attach about 10 millimeters above the lowest end of the cartilage. You know, the surgery I do where I open up to the feminization laryngoplasty change the voice, I get to look at it. So I measure it each time.
That's right.
And I would say if you aren't going to put a camera in and know exactly where it is, the next best thing, which I'll probably tell at my next meeting, is leave 10 millimeters of cartilage there no matter what. So that's maybe a second approximation for how to be accurate.
And do you ever work with transmasculine individuals as well? And if so, how would you say your visual observation of transmasculine thyroid development or cartilage development is? Would you say that it's sufficient, or would you say that if someone is starting testosterone, maybe in their 20s, they get less of that tracheal cartilage, or what's the development there that you've seen?
Well, I don't have a great end from a scientific standpoint of having seen a lot of people, but the people I've seen, it doesn't tend to grow a lot with exogenous testosterone later on. the pitch changes a fair amount in most people because the soft tissue of the vocal cords, I think, bulks up.
Bulges and thickens.
But the hard cartilage, I don't really typically know if it comes out much more. I haven't seen it much, and I don't know.
Okay, so
I have occasionally put an implant in one or two people trying to give them one.
Yeah, that's what I was wondering. So there is actual tracheal implants for masculinization. You kind of grimace a little. How do you approach that?
I think that's still up in the air how it could be done well. Mm-hmm. I have most individuals don't have a lot of extra cartilage, but I've cut off the top part that's back here and not visible and tried to put it in the front.
Yeah.
And I've tried to use a nasal implant in one person and set it there. There are two issues with it. One, you want something to protrude, but when a trans man, their larynx may not drop very low in the neck. It's still for pretty high. If you put the bump up high, it may still be like under the chin, mm-hmm. kind of, which is where a lot of females are naturally. And then in men who've had testosterone, some of their larynxes sit down.
Yeah, it's crazy.
Way down here. I think there's room for improvement on that, but.
Excellent. So in terms of the feminizing tracheal procedure, tracheal shave procedure. So we talked about one of the complications being the anterior commissure detachment. What can you tell us about the subcutaneous tracheal adhesion? It was brought up in chat a moment ago. Someone said, I've heard that when surgery is successful, the buildup of scar tissue can be a major obstacle. There has been a trans woman in the community who made a pretty popular YouTube video who found that her tracheal shave issue was subcutaneous tracheal adhesion. So is that easy to resolve? What is subcutaneous tracheal adhesion?
Yeah, I think there's two parts that play into it. One is some people scar more than others. So mm-hmm. if you tend to scar a lot, you might get those. And the other has to do with the surgeon in there. The less you do the tissue, the better. The more that you undermine and scrape around and do things, then the more likely it is to scar. But my experience with scar has been, mm-hmm. of course, I make my incision visible in the neck. And if someone does get a tethering there, then I would just excise the scar, reach underneath and separate it and close it up. And usually that secondary procedure to release the scar isn't very traumatic. You're doing very little. You just cut through the scar tissue and sew it up so it doesn't tend to re-scar it.
So for individuals who are suffering from subcutaneous tracheal adhesion, that is a fairly successful revision process?
I would, especially if the scar is attached itself. So if there's a lot of stuff stuck down everywhere, probably a little less so. Mm-hmm. But if the scar itself is moving when you swallow, like it's stuck down, generally cutting that out and just lifting it up and reclosing it is enough to deal with it. Mm-hmm. If it's fairly extensive, then it's probably you're thinking about steroid injections into the tight spots to get the scar to relax.
Okay, perfect. And now what about other potential risks or complications of the tracheal shave procedure? I know that the anterior commissure detachment and the subcutaneous tracheal adhesion are two physiological or anatomical examples that we can see of risks, but I'm curious what you think about maladaptive behavior. This is something I've seen in some cases in my experience where, you know, someone will come to me and they'll say, oh, you know, I got this procedure and it's really impacted my voice. It's been like this for 7 or 8 months. And then I'll work with them. And over the course of maybe 2 or 3 sessions or 4 sessions, they can very easily get their voice back to proper function. And it appears that some disruption or disturbance or maybe the voice rest or something causes them to adapt to the new structure of the instrument differently. Do you have any thoughts on that hypothesis?
I mean, I can see that even in people who have just a voice problem. People can develop maladaptive behavior not having any surgery at all.
I remember that was one of the revelations that you taught me when I went in with a vocal injury in 2018. You were like, just yell. I need you to start yelling because you're not actually injured. You think you are, but you're not. So anyways, sorry to interrupt you. What were you saying?
No, we can develop behaviors. And so I'm not certain so much that that's related to the surgery or obviously related to it. Mm-hmm. But if you aren't certain, it's certainly worth a try at fixing it that way because it's very low impact. you know, to work on it through sort of a therapeutic approach. So
Now, are there any other sort of left tail or right tail risks associated with that procedure, sort of outlier risks that maybe crop up once in a blue moon that we should know about?
I haven't really seen them. I mean, anytime you make a cut, you could get bleeding or an infection. Okay. That's pretty low with this procedure because it's a pretty clean procedure. Mm-hmm. I don't know about going through the mouth where you would potentially contaminate it from the mouth, but when anytime an incision somewhere in the skin goes through, it's a pretty safe surgery. So I really only know about the two issues you've talked about so far.
Okay, thank you so much. We really, really, really appreciate that. What would you say is the satisfaction rate on your experience with that procedure?
Well, I mean, it depends. And when for all the procedures I do, when someone asks me the satisfaction rate, I don't have an answer. I have people say that I do alter their voice and it doesn't sound very good and they're extraordinarily happy with it. And I have other people that sound great and aren't happy with it. So the same is true for a trach shave. Sometimes there's still something there because I didn't want to disconnect the anterior commissure. Maybe the patient's happy with it. Maybe they're terribly unhappy. But then I say, well, the choice is I can take more, but now you will have a high risk of having a drop in pitch. So the satisfaction is hard to predict. Although, of course, the more the surgeon gets off without injuring the voice, the more the person's generally happy.
Yeah, absolutely. In the research that I got with 140 responses, 85% would have still chosen to follow through with the procedure, even if they had complications or whatever. So I think the success rate or the satisfaction rate seems to be, or I should say the regret rate, at least in this population chunk, tends to be about 15%. So I think that's pretty within the range of most surgeries. The main thing is, this is something I really I'm thankful I have an opportunity to share with you. The most startling finding of this research that I did was I asked, do you feel you were properly informed of long-term vocal risks by your surgeon?
Yeah.
34% said, yes, I was made well aware of long-term risk. 30% say somewhat, long-term complications were briefly mentioned. And 35% say no, long-term vocal risk was not mentioned at all. Which is just like, you know, that seems almost like criminal to me. Like, I feel most other surgeries, you know, there's pretty clear discussion about risks, but it seems that some of the individuals that practice the chondrolaryngoplasty are not aware of it or something. So, yeah.
It's a mix. And I think that probably actually pretty accurately reflects reality. I mean, of course, it'd be great if four other people did a study and they all matched up, but
for sure,
I would say that actually applies even to more surgeries than the one you're talking about.
So. And do you tend to do this procedure in conjunction with the voice alteration surgeries?
Well, so the procedure we may talk about, the feminization laryngoplasty that I do, would be like the biggest trach shave ever. So if I'm going to take the voice box apart to shorten the vocal cords, I'm going to do two things. I'm going to make it smaller than anybody can make it with a trach shave.
Because you're structurally.
I'm taking off the whole front.
Wow.
And I don't have to worry about, because I am detaching the vocal cords and then I'm hooking them back up again.
So then, actually, go ahead. Yeah.
There's a second part to that. And that is that I also pull this up in the neck for resonance reasons, but that also tucks in any remaining bump up under the chin.
Perfect. Actually, let's get into the vocal feminization procedures. I think that would be great.
Sure.
I can't wait to learn more about your procedure in particular. But first, could you maybe, if you have the knowledge of this, could you maybe give us a rundown of the history of gender affirming vocal surgery? Like, what was the first procedure you saw people doing? It sounds like it was the cricothyroid approximation. What has been the evolution in the field that you've seen in your time in the field?
Well, in the 1970s, there were a few people that tried a few things, like they published case series of two people or three people or five people. And various things were done. For instance, one was to just cut a little wedge and tip the wedge forward. Well, that would make, of course, the thyroid cartilage more protuberant.
Wow.
And it probably wasn't very successful because no one repeated the study. They didn't do it again.
And that was in the 70s?
mid-1970s.
Okay.
I think the first one that, and there's probably a few other things that people tried that weren't really successful. And the first thing that became popular was the cricothyroid approximation. And so I would say, and that was really becoming popular in the 1990s. I don't know the whole reason why not much happened before that. There's a lot of things that play into transgender surgery mm-hmm. and politics and
culture and all of it.
Culture and all that. But by the 1990s and early 2000s, cricothyroid approximation was becoming fairly popular, and it's so easy to do that not only ENTs were doing it, but plastic surgeons were doing it who never otherwise operated on the voice box you just put a stitch in and pull it tight.
That's crazy.
So, and my frustration with it led me to switch to something else. And I think other people just were a little slower on the frustration level, but other people became frustrated. Now there's people who still do cricothyroid approximation.
Yeah, it's wild.
So, but that was the first. And then the next sort of surgery, I was doing the feminization and giving talks about it, was sort of a second one. And then the third one was this vocal webbing. And there's some variations on it, but it's basically the vocal cords are inside. You put a microscope, look down the mouth, mm-hmm. you remove the skin from the front half, and you pull that together and you stitch it together, and you've made a web or an adhesion here. And now only the back half of the vocal cord vibrates.
So is that like an anterior webbing, or is that webbing done posteriorly?
Anterior.
Gotcha. And so there's these different types. So you mentioned the cricothyroid approximation. Can you tell us, you can go
ahead. So cricothyroid approximation, vocal cord webbing, feminization, laryngoplasty. And then also in the early 2000s, there was a laser procedure to try and debulk the vocal cords. So think about it as sort of, there's four different surgeries that are variously popular.
Yeah, so can you tell us a little bit about how the cricothyroid approximation works and why it's not a satisfactory result in most cases?
Yeah, I can tell you why I don't like it. I mean, there are still surgeons who like it, let's say. So you have the Adam's apple or thyroid cartilage, and right below that, you have another cartilage called the cricoid. Mm-hmm. And in fact, in most genetic females, the cricoid sticks out further than the thyroid, and most genetic males, the thyroid sticks out further than the cricoid. But you have these two cartilages. They're connected by a joint in the back. And when you pull the cartilage together, you go up into falsetto. You tighten and lengthen the vocal cords. So yeah, there's your thyroid cartilage, that one with your index finger. And the cricoid is big in the back and very tiny in the front. In fact, in your diagram, it looks a little bit like a tracheal ring, but that first little gap below the thyroid cartilage, when you go into falsetto, you're pulling those two together. The effect of that rocking is that the vocal cords get pulled longer. They get stretched out. So I like to think of the vocal cord function. I'll step back away from your question. Mm-hmm. We've got two muscles in the vocal cord that raise pitch, and one is the vocal cord itself that tightens. So I've just tightened the muscle that is the vocal cord. Mm-hmm. And then I add in the cricothyroid muscle, and I can go from So that break between is sort of the two muscles transitioning.
While we're on this topic, how do we lighten the voice without going into falsetto? So for instance, I understand that the primary approach, so if you raise your pitch and you mostly keep the same weight and the same density of your sound, that's like the first movement you're talking about. And then the second movement you talked about was What about this third movement of
That's kind of the blending of the two muscles.
Okay, got you. And it's just those two. There's got to be a little bit more, yeah?
No. Hmm. You've got, in your voice box, you have symmetry. So you have muscles on each side. Mm-hmm. But you have one in the vocal cord. You have one to stretch the vocal cord. You have one to bring them together. Mm-hmm. You have one to open them. And you have one that's, once you bring them together, it keeps them together, the interarytenoid. So that's all the muscles you have.
Okay.
So you have two muscles to change pitch, and then you have a muscle to open and close for breathing and making sound.
I have a question now that you've said that. So I've been aware of that model that positions there to be these two antagonistic forces. That's often how I'll talk about it with certain students. But I assumed that there were other elements in play, like other details, at least in the terms of the musculature, that wasn't accounted for in that two-piece model. So one question that I have is, one of the things that can happen in trans feminine vocalists when they're trying to learn this through a behavioral approach is they can have a lot of difficulty lightening their voice without going in falsetto. And I actually have a question for you from a different doctor, from Dr. Powers, if you know who he is. He's an endocrinologist. He likes to come up with weird things, and we were talking one day and he was like, what if you inject, this is just a hypothetical curiosity, what if you injected Botox in either of those, actually? What happens to the vocal function if you inject it into the cricothyroid versus the thyroarytenoid? And that is the opposite pair, right? The thyroarytenoid or the vocalis muscle? What is the opposite to the cricothyroid muscle that you're talking about?
Well, I don't know of an opposite muscle to the cricothyroid. So
antagonistic, sorry.
Right, I don't know of an antagonistic one. It just relaxes when it's not being used. Okay. Just the ligaments pull the larynx back into the position they were in. Mm-hmm. And then you had several questions there. One, vocalis and thyroarytenoid are the same thing. They're two names.
That's what I was thinking. The vocalis is the inner core or the inner component of the thyroarytenoid.
Or it is the thyroarytenoid muscle. Yeah.
Gotcha. Okay.
So you have these two muscles to lengthen them, but when they quit lengthening, there's no antagonistic muscle to pull it the other way. They just relax. So there's a relaxed state and a tightened state.
Okay.
That's as opposed to the opening and closing, where the lateral cricoarytenoid closes it and the posterior cricoarytenoid opens it. So there you have two antagonistic muscles, but the vocal cords themselves, when they tension inside, they just tighten up. When they relax, there's no opposing muscle to...
I appreciate that. That adds some great clarity to my understanding. So what would happen if we just hit them with some Botox? Would it just be the same as if you just had it in the relaxed state when you're vocalizing, or...?
Well, there's two things that happen when you use Botox. One, some of it gets in the muscle you want, and it weakens it. And two, the more you put in, the more it spreads out to neighboring muscles, so you get some side effects as you put in more and more. Mm-hmm. I put Botox in the larynx a lot for people with spasms. If you put it into a muscle, the muscle can't do as much. Mm-hmm. So if I inject your vocalis or your thyroarytenoid muscle, it just impairs your singing range. Mm-hmm. It a little bit impairs your volume because some of it leaks into the muscles, the LCA, so you can't quite close as tight because the LCA and the TA, thyroarytenoid, and the lateral cricoarytenoid sit together like this. So it's really not possible to put Botox here and not have some of it get here because they just sit right against each other. If you put Botox in the cricothyroid muscle, then you lose top end. You can't get as high up in pitch.
Right.
If you put Botox in LCA muscle, you can't close, and then you end up with water dripping in the lungs.
Whoa, so water. So actually, that makes sense. So you actually can't even protect your airway if you were to put Botox in the thyroarytenoid.
Well, no. I mean, the thyroarytenoid muscle.
Because you still have the vestibular folds above it that could block, and the epiglottis. Well,
you have the lateral cricoarytenoid that will bring them closed. And if you start to get Botox in the lateral cricoarytenoid, the gap gets bigger and bigger. If you only put it in the thyroarytenoid muscle, in general, you can still close all of it.
Okay, that's what I was wondering. Okay, that is so fascinating. I think I speak for all of us. We really appreciate this knowledge, and it really means a lot. So now, getting back on the topic of the voice surgery, sorry, we tangentially went off.
Yeah, it's okay.
I was too curious.
It's related.
So talk to us about, so the cricothyroid approximation, so we get that, you just pull that tighter, basically impairs the vocal function a little bit, limits it to a higher range, gives you a more falsetto-like tone. Can you talk to us about the difference in the outcome of the web glottoplasty versus the LRG or the laser glottoplasty?
Well, before we jump to that, let me finish with the Craigslist thyroid approximation, because the problems with it are that you tighten the vocal cords and you, one, the quality tends to be falsetto-like, mm-hmm. or as some patients tell me, gay male-like, like mm-hmm. they're talking like that.
Right.
Two, you've lost that muscle, so you've lost half of your ability to go up.
Mm-hmm.
Three, in about a third of patients, then the vocal cord stretches out. So now you no longer have the muscle that goes high and your pitch drops down and you've lost half your vocal range. So, and then the fourth complication is when you fix a joint so it can't move and you put these two stitches in, you tighten it up. Now the joint between the thyroid and cricoid can't move. Mm-hmm. It fixes in position. And mm-hmm. a few people, I don't know, probably 2 or 3% get locked into a single pitch where they can't go up or down. And then they're just talking like this and they go, and they're kind of stuck on one or two notes. And that's a pretty severe complication. So those are the downsides. And I think they're pretty significant downsides. And with a 30% failure rate, any surgery that's better than 30% failure rate is going to be better, and that leads you to the webbing or these other procedures, and none of them have a 30% failure rate. So
gosh, that's wild. Thank you so much.
So moving on now, you wanted to ask about webbing
versus laser. You can start with webbing if you want to talk about that process first.
Well, and historically laser came first. It didn't do much, so it was kind of abandoned.
Mm-hmm.
And then I'll get back to why it can work.
Okay.
But webbing came next after this one paper on laser.
Mm-hmm.
And there's sort of, it's gone through an evolution. So there's two versions of tying the vocal cords together out there. And it is the most popular, again, mm-hmm. because it's a relatively easy surgery. So ENT surgeons feel comfortable doing it. It's similar to other surgeries they do.
Mm-hmm.
And it's almost certainly the one everybody will run into if they check in with their neighborhood person.
Mm-hmm.
So webbing done through a microscope in the mouth, you're completely asleep, straighten your head out, microscope looks right down here, and then the surgeon can use a laser or scissors and cut off some of the lining of the vocal cord, bring them together and suture them closed. Mm-hmm. Most surgeons put one or two stitches in. If you put three in, I don't think that matters a whole lot, but you just end up with the front half together.
Mm-hmm.
And because your voice, the pitch that you hear, is made up, a particular sound wave is made up of mass, length,
tension.
And tension.
Yeah.
So this procedure is basically altering length.
Mm-hmm.
It's leaving mass alone. It's leaving tension alone. It's altering just the vibrating length and cutting it in mm-hmm. about half.
You could say, though, this is something I'm curious. You could say, though, that the length does have a also direct relationship on effective or implied mass in the thing, because the degree of
sure.
stiffness will change, the overall degree of active movement will change. So the length and mass in some ways seem to be a bit related when it comes to the vocal folds.
Well, they are related. If you had a guitar string, mm-hmm. if you had the low E
exactly,
string and you
yeah.
cut it in half and you tied it to your guitar,
mm-hmm.
it would be half the length and half the weight, right? I mean,
mm-hmm.
you are affecting weight, but mass per unit length,
mm-hmm.
would be kind of the same.
Mm-hmm.
So yes, when you cut the string in half or when you push your finger down, you doubled the pitch. So,
mm-hmm.
but you haven't changed the mass per unit length of that string. And that string, as you get shorter and shorter, you mentioned, is going to get like this quality of tightness or tension as
absolutely.
You get down to, you know, a tiny bit. So if you really want to get higher, you really have to make it thinner. Thus, the guitar has six strings so that you can have a thin mm-hmm. string also.
I love that. Thank you so much. And so how does a surgeon determine how much to web? Do they just kind of wing it? Like, I mean, obviously, you can only speak for yourself.
Yes. But... No, they kind of just wing it. But the general consensus is that it's about half.
Okay.
And the surgeon who does more than that, and some of them do, and I will see someone who comes in with a nice high-pitched voice, and a vocal cord that's 1/10 of the length it used to be, and they have no volume.
Oh my gosh. Wow.
You just cannot get loud if you're down to 10% of your vocal cord.
You can't build enough resistance. You can't build enough resistance with that tiny length kind of.
Yeah. You can't put enough air behind it to.
Yeah. That's so fascinating.
So And anything less than about 10 or 20% doesn't make much change. So I think you'll find most people would say 40 to 60%, and they're probably as precise as they really can be. It's about half of the vocal.
And that's what's the recovery like on that? How long is a person's voice out for? What do they have to do? And is it similar to the recovery for laser?
Well, I mean, you could talk right away. I think most surgeons will ask you not to, because they don't want you blowing air through and tearing the stitches out, and you don't want them to tear out either. So they're probably going to limit the talking in some way to let the sutures heal. And some surgeons are sticking Botox in the vocal cords to enforce the voice rest. Most tissue heals within about a month, so there's probably some restriction in how much air you put through it during that month. That said, every time you breathe, the vocal cords open. So now if you've tied them together here, I mean,
it puts tension on that web.
6 times a minute, you're pulling on it anyway. So there's always, there's going to be some pull on it no matter what. And one of the modifications that several surgeons do is they web it together, and then they use a laser to make a cut on either side to relax the skin and let it kind of fall in easier. So there's a modification that some people do to try and address that.
Thank you. And how
that
is that?
Said, I don't think most people pull apart. That's a complication, but I think most surgeons get a good enough stitch in that it probably stays in there.
Yeah, absolutely. And how's that different from laser? So in laser, you are reducing mass of the vocal folds by actually burning off the tissue?
Yeah, I think it's a mix what the laser does. So you have, again, the vocal cords here.
Yeah.
And you're going to take a laser and cut in, leave the edge alone that vibrates, that makes sound.
Okay.
You're going to cut in behind it. Now you're going to remove mass and muscle.
Right.
How much that changes the mass on the edge of the vocal cord, I think it does some, but probably not as much as we would like. And that's why most, like laser surgery alone, probably doesn't change the voice enough. I find it a great supplement.
Yeah.
If you had a web that got you partway there, and then you come in and remove a whole bunch of muscle and try to debulk it, you will get a lift of several notes. But laser alone doesn't generally take you from a male voice to a female. You just can't debulk enough muscle. And because a lot of the weight is just on the edge of the cord itself, the mucosa is what's vibrating.
Yeah.
But that's the goal behind laser. And the other thing is that when you come in with a laser on top and you debulk and you make a cut here, as that heals, it contracts and it pulls the skin.
Is that what causes the air leaks and gaps in lasered voices? Because I have two close friends, I think, who have received laser feminization vocal surgery, and they both have a very subtle air leak that I think the average ear is not going to notice. But when I hear them, I hear this persistent leak.
Yeah, the way to know is to look, of course, and see what's causing the air leak. But the laser does tighten the top surface and pull the skin up and around, so it makes the edge of the vocal cord tighter as well as reducing some mass.
Thank you. And I know I don't want to have to invoke a... I'm curious about if you know what Yison... That's just laser, right? What they do?
So Hung Tae doesn't like to call it surgery webbing. That's fine.
It's a marketing thing.
Well, no, I mean, he has made an advancement. He's taken what people, he himself and others have done, and that is start with the same thing. You're bringing it together and suturing it together. But in addition to that, his goal has been to take, so this is anterior and this is the mid part that you just sewed together.
Yep.
And what he does is, with the stitch here, he pulls this down lower in the neck. So now he's doing not just shortening the length, but he's taking that remaining length
and tightening it.
Tightening it by pulling it lower. So he is doing more than someone else. It does still create a web. So if you look at it, it looks like a web. The stitches look exactly the same, but it is, and I think he's just been doing more of it, pulling that down low, which tensions the posterior vocal cord.
That makes sense. I was curious because that's the surgery that I've heard two air leaks with. Very subtle. They're not like, you know, impairing air leaks that are going to cause, but the texture of the sound quality has shifted to be a bit grainier than what it initially was. So there's the web glottoplasty. There's the laser glottoplasty. There is the cricothyroid approximation. Now, let's start getting into your domain here with the FIMLAR stuff. And before I necessarily poke at that, what is pharyngeal plication? I've heard this like muttered, but I have like, from what I understand, it would be a reduction of pharynx size by ringing it. But how does that work? What is that?
Well, I think both Hung Tae and myself are in the same boat of constantly trying to improve things. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, he's taken the web and he calls it something different, which you could say is marketing, but he has done this additional pull, which has done more. So you do have to come up with a name for it.
That makes sense. Yeah.
And in troubleshooting over time, when I did like the feminization ringoplasty, which we haven't talked about a lot yet, mm-hmm. but it shortens the vocal cords and it makes the whole voice box smaller. And after I started doing that, I started adding something else because mm-hmm. I wanted to do more. And the impact more was, how could I alter not just the pitch, but how could I alter the resonance? Mm-hmm. So the resonance is everything from the vocal cords up, includes the nose, the sinuses, the mouth, the back of the throat, or the pharynx that you're talking about. Mm-hmm. And I think to some degree, it even includes the false vocal cords. That is the upper part of the glottis.
Also, something that you may not be aware of, it will also involve subglottal resonance as well. Now, this doesn't always happen, but anytime there's a gap happening, you get a significant change in the sound quality. There's some really interesting research on subglottal resonance as well. So, yeah, continue. Sorry, I just thought that was an interesting point.
So, as I was developing, or as I've done this, the first people who got the surgery get sort of a different surgery than they do now because mm-hmm. I wanted to suspend the larynx up higher in the neck. Mm-hmm. And in some people, I can do that directly, but some people, their wings of their thyroid cards were so high that I had to cut them off. Mm. And then I could pull it up in the neck. So now I consistently do that in everyone. I cut off the top wings that aren't really visible. They're back here.
Yeah.
But then that allows me to pull this up. So if you take your pharynx, which is a tube that let's say is like 5 inches tall, and you take the vocal cords and you pull them up an inch, you've shortened the pharynx.
Yep.
But resonance depends on volume, not just length. Mm-hmm. So shortening the length is helpful. And then how do you narrow it? And
exactly.
I think an awful lot of what voice therapy does when I put a camera in and film someone who's very successful at generating a female sound, they've been able to narrow the throat.
That's right. I mean, that's like, that's about 70. I mean, okay. It's sexing and sex perception of voice and gendering of voice is a very big gestalt. Obviously, stylistic aspects play, pitch, contour, articulation, whatever. But definitely, the biggest component of the process is reducing enough total volume of the pharynx. And what we can see in some really interesting research is if we go and we look at from prepubertal development to postpubertal development in average male and female voices, what we see is that the actual total vocal tract length, it's only about 20% difference between male and female vocal tracts. But if you look at total pharyngeal volume after pubertal development, it's an 80% increase in volume for average male vocal tracts and only a 20% increase for average female vocal tracts. So if we're looking for where the significant amount of space that we have to carve out and reduce is, it is definitely pharyngeal volume. And I think that it's really awesome. So the pharyngeal plication is a pharyngeal volume reducer approach. How do you do that?
So the preface to that is that there are those of us who are great singers and have great vocal rapport and can manipulate our pitch super mm-hmm. well and match pitch and can manipulate the throat and make it narrow. Mm-hmm. And the individuals who you here are successful, if you put a camera in, you would see they can keep their throat narrow all the time. Whatever it is, they have mm-hmm. the skills to do it.
Yeah.
But then there are those of us that when I say, can you make a note like this? The person goes, mm-hmm. I said, do you know you went down in pitch? What do you mean? You know, mm-hmm. they just have the brain doesn't register pitch and mm-hmm. volume and resonance very well. Mm-hmm. Those individuals don't do very well in therapy. They don't learn how to squeeze it. It's like banging them with a hammer over the head. Mm-hmm. So that's the person who I've at least tried to structurally change the pharynx. And it's a difficult thing to be successful at in the sense that it's a tube of soft tissue. So, but the things that I've done have been to put someone to sleep and like a tonsillectomy, just open the mouth, go to the back of the throat, and instead of taking out the tonsils, just take out a wedge of the throat and then pull that together.
And where in the pharynx would you be doing that? So you said like behind the tonsil, obviously this is a sagittal, mid-sagittal view. So like, would you, like if we, let's say that it was like horizontal, are you going all the way back to like the back of the oropharynx, or are you doing that a little bit lower?
So I start where your finger was in the oropharynx and then go inferiorly. And I try to get to the larynx, but it gets harder and harder to reach down. I can't even get down to where your finger
and you
is.
Do it, and you do it on the sides, not the anterior.
I've tried it both ways. I've taken a central elliptical wedge out and then pulled it together. I've tried to take out one on each side and pull that together. I don't know a best way. It is kind of still experimentation in how to get it to tighten up and heal up. And then it's hard to measure. I mean, first of all, some people don't come back. If someone comes back and I look in there and I see the scar tissue, how much did the remaining tissue stretch on its own?
You know, you could measure it quite simply acoustically, where you basically have the person come back in your office, have them produce before the surgery, have them produce a specific vowel, like saying ah, putting white noise or brown noise into their vocal tract, and then measuring the impulse off of a reverse filter. And then you could have them come back in their follow-up and then have them do the same vowel structure. Obviously there's some behavioral variance that might happen there, but then when you put the noise back in, then you actually get to measure exactly how much that resonance modification actually created in the passive structure. So that could be an approach that you could use to sort of get some tangible acoustic measurements of the influence of resonance on the procedure.
I think it's possible to measure it, but the part of the caveat will be, of course, your mouth and tongue, how much you open and close that. That's a big variable in terms of the chamber doesn't end until here.
Right. I mean, if you could get someone to produce the same static position they were in before, then you would be able to get all of that information about the vocal tract that is there. And so for, is pharyngeal placation just like a sort of experimental thing that's part of FIMLAR? Can you tell us more about your overall procedure? Let's get into that.
I don't do it as part of FIMLAR, first of all, because there's already a fairly big risk when I cut from the outside of the skin into the inside of your throat of getting an infection. There's bacteria inside, and then that bacteria can get under the skin. So I think it's a risk. It's a big enough risk for me to take the voice box apart and put it back together, but that's all I do.
Gotcha.
If someone comes back and we've settled on the pitch and we still hear this resonance mismatch, then I would mention, look, I'm trying something new. I don't know how well it works. I've done it in some people. And if you can't accomplish in therapy what you want, we can go in and take a wedge out. In principle, it should alter your resonance some. How much, I'm uncertain. And there's people who are willing to take that risk. And then there's people who probably shouldn't be willing to take that risk because.
And so how about the general FIMLAR procedure overall? So from what I understand is your evolution coming to it is you were working with some of those more basic vocal surgeries at first, realized that you needed something other than just a pitch modification because you could hear that the resonance wasn't coming out right. So that put you down this FIMLAR path?
Yeah, I mean, it was both what you said there and the fact that cricothyroid approximation, even when it raised pitch, wasn't the right quality.
For sure.
And then on top of that, I wanted to preserve the muscle that, you know, that gives you the high end.
Absolutely.
So feminization rhinoplasty, I had read an article by Dr. Kunacek, a plastic surgeon in Thailand, who had sort of tried something that I liked the idea of, which was he was trying to remove the front of the voice box and see if he could pull that. So I took that and took it a little farther and went ahead and started removing the front of the thyroid cartilage, opening up the larynx, taking the vocal cords, essentially cutting off the front half, the part that is webbed in the vocal cord webbing. I'm cutting it out and removing it, and then stitching the vocal cords back together. That's the main central part of the procedure. And then when I take off, like you have the voice box here, and if you, let's see, like this, mm-hmm. and you cut off the front and then it collapses together, the thyroid cartilage now is a more female size rather than a, right. you know, a male size. So now the, some of the structure is heading towards a female size. Mm-hmm. I remove the top. Inside the voice box, I also shorten the false cords. So now,
oh, not really? That's cool. Yeah,
so not only are the vocal cords going to be shorter, but that tube yeah, right above it,
totally.
I remove about probably 5 millimeters from the front of each one. So that so takes cool. the mouthpiece and narrows them, you know, narrows the mouthpiece some.
Yeah, absolutely.
So shortening the vocal cords, shortening and narrowing the supraglottis and lifting it up mm-hmm. in the neck, putting stitches through here in the hyoid bone to hold it up in the neck so you Very don't cool. have to. It was the essence of the surgery.
So how long does that surgery take you to perform, and how often do you perform it?
It takes me about 90 minutes to oh, 2 hours.
That's
to do it.
You're in and out quick.
It's pretty quick. Yeah. It's pretty straightforward.
That's awesome.
I mean, I think the, you know, for a young surgeon doing it, the issues just are decisions about how much to take.
Right.
Cartilage, how much to take of the true cords, how much to take of the false cords, where to put the stitches. But it is a simple procedure. You're only doing those things.
And are you the only person in the world right now that does that procedure in particular? Or have you taught other, I know that you train other educators. Maybe you can talk about that at some point, but are you the main individual doing that, or?
I think there's people who want to try it. There's a few people who tried it once and didn't like it. Mm-hmm. I think if you try it once and you never learned how to do it, you're unlikely right. to like it. I've heard a few people say they like it, but I would say I'm still principally the only person doing it. It's a relatively big surgery.
Yeah, and do I have your permission to extract some of the audios that you had on your YouTube channel? And
sure,
so that
yeah,
when
yeah.
we make the video, I can overlay stuff sure. so people can hear the quality and stuff. How would you describe the satisfaction or complication outcomes for Femlar?
Well, I would say, when you go into it, I've done about 300 people. And to answer a question you asked earlier, I do mm-hmm. surgery every other week. So gotcha. There's one or two people every other week, sometimes okay. three. So let's say 1 to 5 people a month, typically. Mm-hmm. Oh, and then back to what question was it?
Risks, complications,
yeah, risk.
So satisfaction.
If you go in, I think, to this or any surgery, there's going to be a failure rate. And I mentioned the cricothyroid one. You have no pitch gain in about 30% of people. I probably have between 5 and 10 people out of 300. So that would be, let's say it's 10 out of 100 would be 10%. So it's about, mm-hmm. it's around 3 to 5% of people that probably get no gain at all. I do the surgery, the vocal cords are short, it's up higher in their neck, and they still have the same pitch. I go back and do a laser tightening mm-hmm. and eventually we kind of give up and we say it's just that I don't know how to solve why your voice didn't change.
Gotcha.
So that would be a complete failure rate.
That's crushing.
Say.
Yeah. I mean, obviously it's a small percent, but that's so sad.
Yeah. So when someone comes to me, I say, you have to be willing to take at least that risk. And if you aren't, then do therapy. Cause there's no risk
there's
to that.
Pretty much no risk. Yeah.
Yeah. Now then when I looked at back at my first, the 180 people I was able to follow up, mm-hmm. It's a bell curve. That is, there's a few people that gained right. only one note or two note, and the middle of the bell curve, the average person gains 6 notes on the piano. Mm-hmm. I have to say, I like piano notes because they're equal intervals. I don't like sure. hertz. I have no clue what a hertz is.
And logarithmic versus linear. All good.
Yeah. So the average person loses 7 notes from the bottom. They mm-hmm. get 6 notes up in their relaxed voice, mm-hmm. as best I can make people be relaxed afterward.
Sure.
And the top end doesn't change. It most
so, okay, that is what I was wondering. So the top end doesn't change, only the bottom
doesn't
end.
Doesn't go higher. And I don't tell anybody you can get a higher singing voice. I
so,
can't.
Well, that takes it off my list. I was like, maybe I'll get this someday. I don't know.
Yeah,
I'm joking.
No, I wouldn't do it.
Yeah, yeah. I'm joking. So, yep. But the tessitura changes? Is that correct?
There, well, I mean, I would, that's why I put the voices up on the internet, and you can't just listen to the best one. You need to play
all of them,
10 of them or 20 of them, and say that they're acceptable to me because they're different. They aren't, there's no one consistent way it comes out.
Right.
I mean, I think the ultimate success for me is a person who says, I left the trans community. I'm a female now. I never think about anything. I just talk. I mean, they just feel like a woman because that was what it was before.
And would you say that that's a big section of the population that you get? I know that on your YouTube channel, you had talked, and I think it would be good for us to have this discussion here in a bit about the, you know, the individuals listening, choosing an option between, you know, training their voice behaviorally versus going through surgery. I know that you had mentioned a lot of the individuals that you recommend vocal surgery for is the individuals who are like, I want to never be able to produce those low notes, and I want it to be gone. I want the physiology of the instrument to be different. Is that what you tend to see when you're working with voice surgery?
Well, I think I encourage, when I to give talks to other surgeons, that's what, and when I give you the talk in my office, I really wanted to find, do you want to never sound male or do you want to sound female when you talk? Because if you want to just sound female when you speak, there's at least the potential you can get that way with practice. If you want to never sound male, you could technically say speech therapy fails 100% of the time, because everyone still has the anatomy to sound male.
All right, so this is what I wanted to push you back on, because I saw this in your video, I want to contest this, okay? Because I don't agree with what you say. I do agree that the underlying physiology of my voice is the same, maybe. However, I've already seen in multiple cases and my own, my inability to access the low notes that I once had. I used to be able to sing down to a G2 at my lowest. When I was in your office 4 years ago, when my voice was injured and I wasn't even talking, the lowest I could get was like a C or C sharp. And often when I'm like going throughout my day, the lowest I can produce is a D3 or an E3. And that has been almost 6 or 7 semitones or 8 semitones worth of loss on the low end as I've started transitioning my voice. Now, I've been at this for 8 years and or seven, 8 years. Now, it's not just me. I have had several students who have experienced the exact same thing. In fact, when I told my community that I was going to do a stream with you, I had mentioned this particular point of contention I want to talk to you about. And there were multiple people in the community who were like, I can't produce my low notes at all. And for me, I actually spend about 30 to 45 minutes a day practicing my male voice just so I have at least a facsimile of it to bring out when I'm doing demonstrations. Like if I go down in pitch right now, we get this kind of experience happening. Even if I try to get as heavy as possible, I cannot produce the degree of weight and mass that I need to generate the low pitches that I used to have. So I'm wondering if in your analysis of that, like I agree on like a physiological level, yes, theoretically, let's say I behaviorally trained again for an extended period of time to get a masculine voice, I'd be able to get that back because of the physiology being the same. But to me,
well, no, because of the anatomy being the same, you have not.
That's what I mean. Yeah, the anatomy, the physiology is the same. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So, right, but that kind of looks past the behavioral component of voice, which is ultimately what voice is. I mean, if we just have physiology happening and there's nothing, you know, there's no behavior running it, there's not going to be any sound. And so like the output result is dependent on behavior and physiology together. And while I agree that, you know, I will always have that physiology unless I change it, the functions that physiology can perform are not always permanent or fixed. Just like in the case of someone who has, for instance, someone who's a vocal underdoer and they were mute for 5 years, they lack the basic function to execute general things. And yes, they could develop that, but you wouldn't say 100% that they can do that right then. And I would say that it's a very similar thing here, where my hypothesis is that rebalancing the way that you produce your sound between the thyrovocalis and the cricothyroid, rebalancing the way you produce your sound and then normalizing in that rebalanced position reduces your faculty and your function with other coordination pairs. So that's my sort of argument pushback against that, because like I have been doing music all my life. I'm a voice expert. I've taught thousands of people. I've done my voice and I cannot sound male very easily. Like maybe if I wake up in the morning and I'm sick and really mucusy and I really try, but like on a day-to-day basis, I cannot sound male. And that includes like my reflexive sounds all sound female, my sneezing, my coughing, throat clearing. And those were deliberate things that I trained, but after I've trained them, they just happen. I don't have control over them unless I force it.
Well, I would say that there are people who have excellent vocal rapport, and you've developed that.
Absolutely.
But I would say you still have the anatomy.
For sure.
We could get a male sound out. And most of the people I run into who come to me are resisting going down. They've actively developed a behavior that they don't want to undo. Mm-hmm. And I don't have a reason really other than a scientific interest in knowing what their lowest note is.
Yeah, totally.
I only push so hard when someone comes in and I...
Yep. See, and I totally agree.
You're holding tension there. Now, I think I'll take your example and take it to the extreme. So someone who has mutism, who's never spoken for 20 years, you would argue they don't have the capacity to speak based on your...
They could develop the capacity. I think they have the underlying capacity. I work with individuals like that.
I would bet that if someone stuck a knife in their back and they screamed, they would actually make a sound. They're mute. They are mute. It's cognitive. It's fair to say that we all have things going in our brain. That's why gender is different than sex. Mm-hmm. But to say, I mean, I'll buy into your argument enough to say failure is way more likely with therapy than it is with surgery, because you will not get a male sound out of one of my patients who has been successful.
So, and by failure, you mean like the ability to not produce that lower end, basically.
Yeah, so if, let's say of the people who have excellent results with me, let's say half have an excellent result. Those people could not sound male if no matter how long you train them, because they no longer have the anatomy to do that. But you have great vocal rapport. That's if there was some reason why you wanted to sound male again, you could take the training and you could do it.
Yeah, well, that's the thing that I'm really that most fascinated by. I do want to have the ability to sound male now. I didn't for years. But now it's honestly really frustrating when I'm recording a cappella and I can't even give myself bass. I have to literally play and program in bass lines in order for me to have rich a cappella textures. So they're like, for me, I definitely think early on for 2 or 3 years, I totally behaviorally avoided it. You know, there was that conscious avoidance. But now it's the opposite. I want those low notes back and I can't seem to get them, and I do have excellent vocal rapport, and that's what is so interesting about this. Like, I suspect there is a different conditioning happening in the instrument that in order for me to undo it, like if I talk feminine permanently, which I do even in my sleep every moment of my life, we could say that, you know, 90% of the behavior I'm doing in my day-to-day life is feminine vocalization. So it's like, you know, me trying to deliberately practice a couple minutes a day or an hour a day doesn't seem to have a big enough impact in my coordination function to return the masculine sounds back. Otherwise, I would
enjoy there's it. Two things. One is, let's take the big group between you and the patients I've been successful in surgery with.
Absolutely.
And the bulk of that group are fearful that at the wrong moment, they're still going to sound male, because they do sound male inadvertently.
Yep.
And speech therapy has a much lower success rate than a surgery does, because the surgery changes the anatomy. So even if we don't want to do an absolute, it is still way different.
That's really interesting. And I feel a lot of contention towards that, because I get a success rate of, you know, 60 to 80% of people that I work with. And it's a bell curve sort of situated around like 70% success rate. And by success rate, I think we have different definitions of that. So success rate for me, like the ability to never sound male, is something that I get a lot from my students. And when they ask that, I tell them how I accomplished that. And, you know, then they can pursue that if they wish to invest the time in it. Because like you've made very clear, very big time investment for voice training. That's the key to it. It's very time and consistent. But then, you know, it seems that you tend to define success as in never being able to, quote,
slip. I'm saying find the patient, what the patient wants.
Okay, there we go.
If you come to me and you want to never sound male, then the surgery becomes...
Yeah, I agree the surgery would be more effective more in that situation.
Cost-effective option. Right. But if you come to me and you say, I just want to be able to sound female, and let's say you're very risk-averse, mm-hmm. you absolutely should only do voice therapy.
Completely
so
agree.
It's not about, it's not really what I think. I mean, my mm-hmm. thought is you tell me why you want to do it and I'll tell you how to weigh surgery and therapy.
I think that's really great. Let's actually talk about that. So for people listening, you know, I think one of the things with surgery, my perspective on surgery has always been if you understand the risks and you understand the potential upside and that's something that you want and your dysphoria, you know, is really significant, sounds good for surgery if you understand the risks. And then yeah. for like you've said with the voice training thing, the difference is surgery, you know, overnight, a month later, 2 months later, there you go. You know, it's done. That's yeah. that's your result or a couple months. Whereas yeah. it is true that it's a significant commitment and it requires, and some individuals, like I personally hold the belief that every person that I've talked to, maybe with the exception of extreme left tail end on the bell curve, can feminize their voice, their behavior. I've worked with people who are the lowest, heaviest, biggest vocal tract structures that I've ever heard in my life. And I have heard them produce sounds that totally work in society and that they don't have any trouble maintaining or producing. Now, of course, in those cases, that's not like the absolute average, right? If you have a larger vocal tract and or lower pitch and lower weight, like it will be a little yeah. more difficult. You'll have your own unique challenges going through the process. But I've yeah. pretty much have met every sort of extreme, I guess, on that sort of bell curve. And it seems like mm-hmm. everyone has the capability. And this is something that I think is interesting what you're talking about. You know, you tend to view vocal rapport, it seems, almost as an intrinsic component of someone's abilities. And I tend to think that there is a disposition. You know, some people are naturally going to be better at sound. Some people are going to be worse. Yeah. We can see that yeah. cognitively. But I do yeah. think that metacognition can be developed through good education that allows people who have let's say, inherently weaker rapport to develop an interface with their own voice and ears to then gain that rapport. I don't think they're locked out of that forever. Although obviously cases of amusia and stuff, that's a different game altogether as a neurological condition.
What you're saying is true, that it mm-hmm. is a huge spectrum. Mm-hmm. But if I have poor vocal rapport, mm-hmm. I'm going to have to spend a longer time in therapy and maybe mm-hmm. I don't want to do it. Maybe mm-hmm. I do want to do it. I yeah. think it's weighing your time, your yeah. intrinsic rapport, and your risk tolerance.
Absolutely.
And the discussion that you or I should have with anybody that comes to us is where do you fit and I fit, where does the patient fit?
I love that.
In that spectrum. And
absolutely.
And you can help them evaluate that. Someone who has poor vocal rapport, doesn't mm-hmm. have time, has lots of money, wants to be done with it and not think about it, then surgery
is like becomes, the only, yeah.
Well, it's not that, I don't want to go to that extreme. It's just, it's a very valid, it's a very it's a very rewarding way of going because right. you can, it saves time in your life.
Absolutely.
You're done with it. And then somebody who has great rapport and already sounds good, I really just would not go for the surgery. I mean, why would yeah. you go for the surgery? I can make you sound a lot worse than you do now.
Yeah, that's how I feel. Yeah. And that makes a lot of sense.
And then the people in between, mm-hmm. well, you can help them weigh those things and they can head one way or the other.
I love that.
I just don't require therapy in order to have surgery. Yeah. If that's where you want to go.
I mean, I personally think that is a bit excessive. I know, like, that's obviously suggested. And I do personally suggest, like, on a personal level, if you are interested in surgery but haven't done any training, I would suggest, like, oh, yeah, maybe you should explore a little training. But if they're like, hey, I want to do this.
There's two reasons you should yeah. do it. One is you should see what it can do.
Exactly.
And two, even an extensive surgery like the feminization rhinoplasty doesn't do everything.
That's what I was about to ask. Can you talk about the limitations of that?
Yeah, it doesn't change the whole resonant cavity. So mm-hmm. you lose almost nothing mm-hmm. except time and money by doing therapy. Mm-hmm. And then you should take in your mind and say, well, how much is that time and money worth to me?
That's,
but I mean,
You know, another thing, I recently actually got my first like publication in the Clinics of Otolaryngology, gender affirming chapter stuff. And one of the things I talked about in that was for vocal surgeons to be aware, which I think this is also something that I think you're acutely aware of, but I don't see this so much where, you know, another thing that surgery doesn't change other than just like general resonance and stuff, unless you get some procedures to do that, is style. How you articulate, how your tongue moves when you form sounds, how your pitch contour actually changes when you're talking. And there's so many things about gender perception and sex perception that are cultural themes and cultural melodies and cultural patterns that reflect a person's history and socialization in the culture that can never be expressed by surgery, because you can't, you know, you can't suture someone's vocal folds and make them literally have different patterns. You know, you can maybe change the range. And so I think that's another important component. One thing that I suggest, and I don't know if you want to explore this, obviously depends on the patient, but one thing that tends to work for students when they're trying to develop more feminine speaking style outside of so the way I think about it is there's aspects about the voice that we can deal with, and this is a model where we can hear some things tend to change the perception of the physiology. Like, for instance, resonance or vocal weight or pitch, that tends to change perception of physiology, whereas there's other aspects about the voice which they tend to reflect more a history. It's not really a physiological question, like, for instance, pitch contour or like slightly sharper S consonances in sounds. That's slightly physiological. But these things, I think there might be ground for individuals to get better results from vocal feminization surgery in a passive way, simply through immersive listening during recovery or post-recovery or whatever, because we naturally acquire style patterns from our environment. If you were to go and live in the UK for years, you know, you'd sound more like you're from the UK. And I think that there's some interesting possible ground there between immersion therapy in conjunction with surgery in order to better transfer style behaviors that aren't addressed by surgery. That's just a thought I think I'd share.
Yeah, I think, you know, when you talk about there is articulation, prosody, mm-hmm. rate, things like that.
Yep.
But one of the big variables in that is if you think that transgenderism is not a mental illness, but it is the way you are, mm-hmm. people are given the option to live in their gender from age zero, mm-hmm. are going to already have all that articulation and yep. prosody and stuff. And you don't need yep. to teach it, because internally that's how they are. Mm-hmm. And someone who grew up older than me was probably forced to be in the gender they didn't want to be
exactly.
in for 50 or 60 years. And they probably need on yeah. average a lot more coaching to change all of yeah. those things you just talked about.
Yeah, I think
but I think given the opportunity to live in your gender from a very young age, you don't need to coach those things.
I totally agree.
The anatomy then. So
we also see those style behaviors change in individuals in the trans community who are like passing in society, and they just exist for periods mm-hmm. of time like that. The style will start to change. Really, really great stuff. Now I was wondering, what do you think
I don't want to finish this. I want one more thing.
Yeah,
I think
please,
the reason I talk a lot about therapy and surgery and weighing with patients is because the background has been ENT doctors want to require a year of therapy or some defined yeah. amount of therapy before considering surgery. Mm-hmm. And I don't get that. I mean, it just varies. One person can do a little, one person could spend 10 years and then decide surgery. But it reminds me of the Harry Benjamin Society, where everyone had to live as a female for a year, get a letter from a psychiatrist.
Yep, I agree.
And that is just such an artificial boundary.
Yeah, I totally.
Therapy is dependent on the person.
I completely agree. And I also think that I'm a very strong advocate for, you know, unbridled body autonomy. So I just think forcing anyone to do something before they can access an alteration of their body is just not right. I mean, obviously as a vocal therapist, I don't really identify that way, but as like a voice educator in this community, obviously I encourage everyone to try out vocal therapy and behavioral modification. But yeah, I'm definitely not for like forcing people to do that, just because I think it impedes on body autonomy quite a lot.
Yeah.
Yeah. Now, did you have anything else that you wanted to add about FIMLAR? I know we're going all over the place, but I'm having such a great conversation with you. One thing I was curious about is the harmonicity or the sort of oscillatory purity that happens when you deal with some of these vocal procedures. Because, you know, from what I understand is if you touch the edge at all, like, you're going to have some degree of asymmetry. I can't imagine that you can really create bilateral symmetry very effectively, or maybe that's wrong.
Well, I think it's a range. So feminization ringoplasty has more asymmetry than any other kind of surgery, because when you put the stitches in, you're putting them in to both sides. But even webbing can end up with asymmetry if one stitch pulls different than the other. So it's not impossible to get asymmetry there. Mm-hmm. I think asymmetry is where the laser really shines, both the office and the mm-hmm. surgical one. And that is, after I put it all together, if someone has asymmetry and the left vibrates at a different pitch than the right, they sound rough, mm-hmm. then it's possible to put a laser in through the nose or the mouth, tighten up the side that is looser, get them back into symmetry. So I think mm-hmm. it's generally possible to re-achieve symmetry. Symmetry doesn't have to be perfect because of physics. So if I have one chord that's a little different than the other, mm-hmm. and this one's vibrating at, say, C4. Mm-hmm. And this side, let's say, is weaker from a nerve injury, or I operated on it and it's mm-hmm. a little looser. As long as this one is driving enough air at C4, C4 is putting that energy into that side. Yeah. So they might vibrate like this, but you'll still be on the same pitch because they're vibrating the same number of times per second. So mm-hmm. symmetry has to be good, but it doesn't have to be perfect.
I believe that phenomenon you're talking about is called mode locking in speech. It's actually, it happens with other things, but voice is one of the most uniquely pure harmonic instruments we can find, period. More harmonic than piano, for sure, in terms of its harmonic accuracy, since the piano has that sort of inharmonicity in the upper partials. And I think it has to do with that mode locking thing. And I think that's really interesting what you were talking about. I think it connects back to that. So
I always think of the 1970s Memorex cassette tape commercial where the person plays the tape and the glass breaks on the other side of the room. Well, that's energy transfer. That mm-hmm. so when you output sound, you are sending energy out into the world. Some of that energy goes to the other cord and makes the other cord vibrate at the mm-hmm. same pitch.
Yeah, that's actually been one of the most profound things as I get more microscopic and attuned to my own voice, is the profound non-linear relationship between so many things. Like, your resonance, the vocal tract structure and whatever the resonance is doing, directly sends information to the vocal folds and changes the way that they vibrate and changes the way that the pitch will feel like you can form it. Different higher resonances will make... Actually, here's a question for you. I've got some nerdy questions.
Yeah, go ahead.
What's going on here? So there's a relationship where the higher your resonance is, the more inaccessible low notes become. And I understand, I already know the reason for this acoustically, where, you know, if you're selecting much higher partials, those are naturally going to be more complex pressure polyrhythms against the vocal folds, which will make it harder to sustain a periodic fundamental. But I'm wondering if there's anything in terms of the soft tissue deformities of the vocal tract that make low pitches harder when we are at much higher resonance. I assume that when we're shrinking the throat and everything like that, it's adding tension or changing the gap of the vocal folds, which makes low pitches harder. Do you have any insight in that?
Because I don't know. That would be like a fun thing to put a camera in.
Let's do it.
You come on up and we'll put the camera in. You do it. We'll film the upper part of the pharynx and the vocal cords, and you can see.
You got me sold. I would love to see that because, you know, at my highest resonance positions, I have trouble producing tones below F3, and that's part of where this having issue in the behavioral population. So trans individuals who feel like they can't keep the pitch high enough, or they're worried about it going lower. I think that mm-hmm. that's part of it, is that my resonance is passively, you know, higher, and it cuts off part of my pitch as a reaction to that process as well. But I don't know, it's just conjecture. So just interesting.
Well, thoughts. I mean, I would conjecture that you and others have learned how to keep muscles tense here that keep the pharynx short.
Totally.
It's seldom I find someone who can't access their low notes that doesn't have tension here.
Absolutely. What do you think is the biggest challenge of the future of vocal surgery? Where do you see the future? Do you know, crazy implants, or like what? if you had to just, you know, sci-fi skeptically, yeah.
I would say the future should be that we identify individuals before they go through puberty, and it's a big political, cultural issue, but mm-hmm. why get exposed to testosterone and then have to undo things? I don't know. That's
yeah. I think though, you know, I love that. I very much agree. However, I feel like you know, you will never be able to identify everyone. There's always going to be
No,
so I definitely agree with that though,
and you'd make more people happier.
Yeah.
If we
I really appreciate that you feel that way as well. I feel that some doctors are very their views on, you know, early transition can be a little inhospitable.
And the thing I won't be able to answer is I operate on people from 80 years old down to 15.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the lower age limit gets into culture and politics and legal.
Wow, that's interesting.
And people ask me, you know, so let's say I get a good result in someone who's age 16 years old. Is it going to last till they're 80? Well, I won't know until.
Yeah, that's a good point. Yeah.
You know, so, I don't know.
You've still got experiments kind of going in the world. Yeah.
But I can return that to the discussion of webbing, which we left a while back.
Yeah, yeah.
And one of my big concerns is that webbing has gone through a big surge in popularity.
Mm.
And all of the articles, if you look online and go to the PubMed, the long-term follow-up is a year or 3 years.
Right.
And then when I see people, I have seen individuals, example cases, where that web has gradually pulled apart over time. And I think until we have some people who publish some good, honest results 5 and 10 years from their mm-hmm. webbing, we aren't going to know how much of that comes apart. I don't think the femoral comes apart. I mean, I followed some people for 18. And secondly, I threw that part of the vocal cord in the trash can. So I don't think it's going to grow back. But I clearly see webbing that gradually pulls apart. So some percentage of people that get webbing are going to gradually lose pitch. Now, maybe they develop like the muscle memory that you've described, and it doesn't matter that the vocal cords get longer and they stay high, or maybe they fall down again. I think there's a big unknown there.
So. Yeah, absolutely. I appreciate that. And how about loudness in femoral? Do you see any reduction? There has to be a little reduction in total loudness.
No, I would tell everybody that goes through webbing or femoral, you're all going to lose volume.
Oh,
it would be the rare person that preserves almost their original volume. But I think you have to count on volume loss with both surgeries.
How do you, so can you maybe talk a little bit about singing voice and vocal feminization surgery? I have seen only one example, and it was on your YouTube channel, of one of your patients. I think she was kind of belting in like a rock project or whatever. And I'm curious about the intersection of singing and vocal feminization surgery, whether that's either at a casual level or professional.
When I was starting it, I wouldn't do a singer at all, but I've done some singers.
Yeah.
And I have some successes, but I wouldn't count on that as a guarantee. I mean, if I were a singer and my career depended on it, I probably would stay the way I was.
That's how I feel.
All the surgeries would impair singing in some way or another, or risk it. The place where I would take the opposite tack is someone who's had a tracheal complication.
Okay.
I can guarantee you that I'll restore some of their singing that they lost or that they want to get, because you really cannot sing with loose vocal cords. So,
gosh, yeah, I love that. Now, do you mind? Do you have a little bit of time for some Q&A from the chat? Okay, cool. All right, folks, if you have any questions for either myself or Dr. James Thomas, feel free to post them in the chat. I'll pull some out. I remembered one before. Someone was asking about training, fellowships, or working with you, or what that's like. Because it seems like there was a medical person in chat.
Yeah. Well, I have people come, whether it's, say, speech therapists or physicians or people who are interested, and they could come as little as to watch one surgery for 2 hours and be done, to people who spend a year here and learn how to do things in depth. So it's just a wide range. I'm generally quite open to anybody who wants to come and observe.
So someone said, would having a tracheal shave now affect your ability to later have VFS down the line?
only if it has a complication. I mean, it does make some scar tissue, but you can go, a surgeon should be able to go through that scar tissue and deal with it. Mm-hmm. It's only if the vocal cords get detached that you're kind of in trouble.
Yeah. So someone asked, how would you personally evaluate your surgery femur at the moment? Would you describe it as the alpha version, the beta version? Is it the full version? Like, how would you characterize where you see it possibly going versus where it's at now?
Oh, I think it's like constant evolution. I would like to have said I've done it for 10 years and now I have it perfected. But no, something new crops up. I still learn new things. Someone will come back with one complication I've never seen. And now I have to troubleshoot. Why did that happen? What did I do? What did the patient do? In fact, I have someone who recently had one vocal cord tear loose on one side. And I've only seen that now twice.
Gosh, what's that do to the sound? Is no phonation at all? Or do we get a p-p-p-p on one side? Or
I think only the covering tore, the muscle is still attached, and it sounds like smoker's polyps. It let the skin loose, and loose skin on the is kind of like a smoker's polyp. It's heaviness in one part of the vocal cord. So we're going to let it heal on its own and then decide to tighten it up later with a laser if it doesn't tighten up on its own. But yeah, something new like that pops up, I'm sure next year I'll find another complication I didn't know existed.
Absolutely. Someone says, how long has vocal surgery for trans and Gen Z people existed? Well, we kind of talked about that earlier. So earlier in the beginning, I asked Dr. Thomas about the history of vocal surgery, and it seems like some of the earliest work was being done in the 70s with an expansion in the 90s and then sort of snowballing now.
I'll tell you when it snowballed is when WPATH got it removed from the DSM manual, which is the mental health manual, put it in the CPT or the ICDM, the medical manual. As soon as that happened, it became acceptable to do it. And it also became acceptable for insurance to consider paying for it. They're not there yet. But as soon as insurance started paying for it, everyone wanted to do the surgery, meaning every ENT doctor.
Here's an amazing question. Someone asks, how drastically does webbing affect the efficiency of airflow? I have a congenital web, and I'm curious if it has contributed to my struggles with voice. It's interesting.
Well, a web does make for some struggles. It's not the same as having female vocal cords. It creates airflow issues. You can get mucus hanging up on it.
Oh, I didn't even think about that. Ooh, that sounds uncomfortable.
Yeah, especially when, like, if you have a shelf. So here, let's say, you know, now you got this V, air is coming up, and now it goes around this thing. So if you do endoscopy on people who have webs, you'll tend to see, and feminizations too, you'll see that mucus often hangs up right on the top of the new anterior commissure.
That makes perfect
sense. Yeah, I mean, webs don't entire, congenital webs or inadvertent surgical webs don't always take a person to a female voice. They can just change the voice. They can make it rough. They can make it air leak, so.
So there's some questions that have already kind of been answered. I'll go ahead and answer. Scap asks, aside from time, is there a comparative advantage to surgery over training? Time seems to be the big one, and then the sort of, let's say, permanence of it, quote unquote, or the inability to get lower, or the locking out of the lower notes. Do you have any other
risk? Well, the risk, I mean, suppose you have a complication and you have a rough voice and from surgery, and then you have to deal with it, and it's either more surgery or you have a problem that kind of stays there, or you get the cricothyroid approximation and you've lost half your range, you're never getting that back.
That's wild. So in cases of cricothyroid approximation, you can't like undo that or anything?
I can't. You know, like if I took your knee and put a stitch around it and locked it into position for a couple months, and then we took the stitch out, you would probably still never run again normally.
Wow.
I mean, there would be stiffness there. And so I do think the side effects and the complications of cricothyroid approximation are pretty permanent.
Someone asks, and then the other question that someone had asked, they said, this surgery both increases high range or reduces low range? So Dr. Thomas answered this earlier. He said that none of the surgeries give you more high end, but they will lock out the low end. So if you're curious about vocal surgery, anticipate that your low end increases, but your high end does not. So you're inherently limiting your range in some capacity, as opposed to just shifting your range. So, and then Clover asks, do you have any major green or red flags for folks considering feminizing or masculinizing voice surgery?
Well, my one red flag is don't do critical thyroid approximation. Go ahead and do a web or do feminization rhinoplasty or try some laser surgery. Mm-hmm. Problems associated with those are relatively fixable if they occur.
Yeah.
And then, I don't know. Maybe
how can we know if the surgeon is trustworthy or, that's funny.
I don't know. If I need surgery, I don't know how, the best I know to do is to ask a nurse who's watched the surgeon work.
Mm-hmm.
It is tough to know who's a good surgeon and not. I don't have a good answer. You know, you look at the message boards, you listen to people who've had it, and you make a decision.
Plank says, knowing the theory behind voice training seems to not help with actually getting it involved. Well, of course, because, you know, talking about biomechanics or acoustic theory is not direct sensory experience, and we can only control our body through direct sensory experience. Like, if you're trying to learn how to dance, you wouldn't read, you know, an anatomical textbook on tendons and muscles and bones. Like, that's not how you learn to dance. You learn to dance by moving your body, and then you start to figure out how things feel, and you settle into it, and then you have more control. So, great observation there, Plank. We can't learn control of the voice through theory. Theory is metacognitive. So after control is in place, after you've experimented and controlled, then you can use theory to metacognitively sort of understand and move around and imagine things that you couldn't have previously imagined. I'd even go one step further than that, and that is
that, you know, there's therapy and there's people that watch YouTube videos.
Thank you. Get it. Yeah, get them. Get them.
Well, yeah. All can only teach yourself so much, and outside, that's why football teams have coaches. That's why tennis pros have a coach. You need, some people are going to learn it themselves.
Yeah, totally.
But a fair number of people are going to need someone to look at them. Even a professional opera singer has someone who teaches them things. Mm-hmm. Typically, they aren't entirely self-taught. So,
go ahead.
No, that's just, I think there's therapy and there's teaching yourself and there's a blend, but they aren't the same.
Definitely. Will any surgeries affect yelling, shouting, singing, or screaming? Yeah, we talked about that already. Mostly all of them, they're going to affect loudness in some capacity. Yep. Many times they'll affect pitch in some capacity, getting it a little bit limited. Screaming involves pitch modification and tension modification. Yep. It's a whole complex process. So you can expect that all those will be influenced in some capacity or another. Does voice surgery affect your vocal fry, falsetto, or whistle range at all? That's a good question.
Well, I mean, of course, vocal fry is kind of low pressure, letting vocal cords oscillate irregularly.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. I think you could do fry before surgery and you could do it afterwards. It just probably would be at a different pitch.
Yeah.
You know, the doing the really high stuff, people have to be kind of skilled to hit a whistle range, at least hitting it, knowing what they're going to hit, not just accidentally hitting it. So mm-hmm. I haven't really done someone who's had that amount of training and seen what the outcome is. I don't know the answer.
I guess maybe if someone has that amount of training and skill, they'd probably avoid surgery in the first place.
They probably would avoid surgery. Yeah. I mean, I would certainly be encouraging them to avoid it.
What happens if you overexert during recovery? Like if you're recovering and you accidentally cough or you accidentally sneeze, are the results ruined?
Well, everyone worries about that. And everyone coughs and clears their throats and talks in their sleep. And I would say almost nobody ruins it. But then there's the case I just told you about where we saw one very recently who had torn the skin away. And although that was only the second person I've seen do that, I think we came to the conclusion it probably was from overusing the voice.
Mm.
So you might be able to overuse it, but everyone who's had any of these surgeries has coughed, cleared their throat, talking mistakenly, and they aren't pulling the surgery apart.
Yeah. Someone asks, do you expect these? Do you expect both? I'll come back to that one in a second, Darvis. Clover asks, if there was anything that you could have every prospective patient know before beginning the process of vocal surgery, what might that be?
Well, I think I try to educate them on this thing that you and I just talked about, which is it helps to clarify what your goals are.
That's right.
And because everyone has different goals. And once you and I know what our goals are, then we can kind of weigh therapy, doing nothing, doing surgery, doing this webbing surgery, doing a big feminization surgery. I think it's about getting on the same wavelength for the provider and the person, and then orienting where they go.
Someone's asking, what's the, let's say, average price on vocal feminization surgery? And do you have a waiting list? That's what someone had asked.
Yeah, I have a waiting list. People who are paying cash, I think the price is around $15,000 for the surgery, the post-op care, the anesthesia, and the rental of the operating room. And that includes some follow-up or some complications that can be handled in the office. Like if I do a laser tune-up in the office, that's included as part of the package price. Gotcha. I don't know what people charge for webbing. I think it varies. Yeah. I'm going to guess.
I think it's about 8,000.
Or 8,000. Yeah. Cause it's about a 1 hour surgery is done, you know, through the mouth. So that would be a very typical price, but.
Someone said they paid 3,700 with Dr. Weidenbecher. And then someone asks, Abigail, if you want to stick around after after Dr. Thomas leaves, I can maybe answer that question, but I'm going to focus on questions now that are more focused towards the doctor, since he's a special guest. A question I saw that was really good. Do either of you, this is an interesting question, I haven't really thought about this. Do you have any experience working with a hyperflexible clients? Hyperflexibility can be the root cause of vocal dysphoria, in that the innate malleability of the instrument is so much greater. I wasn't aware that that was a physical condition. Hypermalleability? Is that?
There are people who have very flexible cartilage. I can't think of the name of the syndrome.
Wow.
And I would be careful about what I did. I've seen one or two people in my voice practice who have this very soft cartilage. People who can just take their tendon, just go all directions. But I would be cautious about any surgery.
And let's see. Mia, we talked actually about all of them. So the voice surgery that Dr. James Thomas is talking about is his own technique, FEMLAR, which is an aggregate surgery that involves a lot of different components and pieces to try to get a better result than something like a basic Windler glottoplasty. Windler glottoplasty was the question. That's basically a webbing with a little tweak, right?
I would say, so Jürgen Windler did a vocal cord webbing in East Germany quite a few years ago, and he went to two meetings and talked about it. And then it was kind of forgotten about for a long time. And when I think when Mark Marmakla in Belgium and now in Luxembourg started doing it, he had seen the announcement from this meeting. And so he titled it the Wendler glottoplasty.
Gotcha.
But if someone says they do it, they're all going to be fairly similar. They're all tying the front of the vocal cords together with one or two sutures. But of course, one surgeon does a bigger stitch. One uses, puts it more posterior, one puts it more anterior. I think the big variation is Hung Tae Kim's that we talked about in Korea, where he puts the stitches in, but also attaches them lower and tensions it. And different surgeons probably will be adding that to their repertoire.
Yeah. Someone says, I just joined, sorry. Does surgery have different results for different people? Yeah, it's extremely diverse. And same with behavioral approaches and therapy. Everyone's going to have a different result always, because we're all so unique and different from one another, both physiologically and behaviorally. Someone says, Gillian, talking about control, is singing training a good addition to voice feminization training? I'll just say this right now. I try to say this as much as I can on my YouTube channel. Doing almost anything with your voice, as long as it is healthy and safe, is going to ultimately contribute to your vocal proficiency as an individual. And the greater your overall vocal proficiency is, the more you will be able to move through voice feminization quickly or through singing quickly. So I think if you are listening, if people are listening out there and they're, you know, getting started with voice feminization or whatever, I mean, the number one thing you should do is make sound. You should be very vocal. You should start making a lot of sound, stretching, you know, playing with pitch, playing with loudness, playing with little random noises, and those will increase your proficiency so that you have the rapport, as Dr. Thomas talks about, to more easily navigate and sculpt the behavioral process. So I think singing is great. Now, I don't think that just like practicing singing is going to feminize your voice or anything, but I do think that, you know, being vocally fit and active is going to increase your function, which will increase your freedom for sure. Theoretically, could there be something implanted in the mouth to act as a permanent modulator? Not right now, but yeah, hopefully in the future. That's what I'm interested in. I really want to design vocal implants. I want to design synthesizer implants in the future, but we'll see. Maybe we can collaborate on that in sometime in the future. Let's see. Oh, this is interesting. I've never heard of this. What about the Ishiki's type 4 thyroplasty? Do you have any idea what that is? I have no clue what that is. I've never even heard that.
Well, I can't keep the 1, 2, 3, and 4 straight, and I'm a laryngeal surgeon, so I never like numbering things. I think it has something to do with pulling, you know, making cuts and then pulling it forward. The problem with just doing that would be that you would make the Adam's apple more prominent. So,
yeah.
So in theory, it would work. I don't know anyone who does it, but.
Frog juice. How do you know if you're being unsafe with your voice? Listen to your body. Your body will typically tell you if you're pushing your limits. I mean, the biggest risks in terms of vocal health stuff are if you're pushing really high with very poor control and you have a lot of irritation or friction, if you're doing scratchy sounds, if things feel scrapey, if things feel irritated, if things are very laborious and fatiguing, dull muscle aches, those are all signs that you're doing something with your voice that's probably not good. If you're getting persistently hoarse, but generally speaking, if you're not pushing your voice crazy loud or you're not going crazy high and you're not squeezing nonstop, you'll probably be good, you know, to explore your voice freely. But just pay attention for those things. Do you have anything you want to add to that? How do you know if a vocal behavior is good or bad?
Well, I think the place where people get caught, I agree with everything you said. Mm-hmm. The place where people get caught is going to a restaurant or a bar at night and they're hoarse the next day.
Yeah.
And that's called the Lombard effect, which is that you are now speaking much louder than you think you are.
Mm-hmm.
And anything that changes the quality of your voice is doing some damage. And if it goes back in a few minutes or a few hours, it's fine. Mm-hmm. But if you're doing that repeatedly, you are doing damage to your voice.
Yeah, Clover and I like to teach our students, you know, technically every single aspect of vocalization has a cost, even if it's a negligible one that heals very quickly and it's fine. But nothing we do vocally is like net neutral. You know, there's always something.
No, I think there's things we do vocally that are a gain.
Ooh.
When you use your voice, you are building up the bulk of the muscles in there. Mm-hmm. I mean,
oh, like semi-occlusions and stuff. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I mean, if people come into my office and I knew nothing about them, I could look at your vocal cords and tell you who talks a lot, who talks medium, and who doesn't talk at all.
Interesting.
Because the vocal cord is nothing but a muscle with skin draped over it,
uh-huh.
And that muscle responds to use. So the only thing I would take issue is with it. You do need to use it, or it doesn't stay in shape.
Yeah, so that takes me back to our sort of little discussion we had earlier about the ability to 100% return to what you could do before. I guess that's part of what I'm curious about is muscular adaptation and conditioning of the muscles into a new position. Could that be a cause for why I see so many people lose the ability to sound masculine after they've been doing voice training for a long period?
Yeah, I mean, it gets back to our discussion that I still think they could get masculine, but there's a lot of mental overhead to getting there. Like you've got muscle memory, and it isn't that you can't undo it, but you constantly forget how to undo it. But there's this,
I mean, I don't have muscle memory of my masculine voice anymore. Maybe on some passive subconscious, you know, neural.
No, you have muscle memory in what you've trained with.
Exactly.
And it's hard to do
that. Like, it's hard to get out of that muscle memory. And like when I talk with if I try to do a masculine voice, it feels so foreign. Like it doesn't feel like it's a voice at all. Someone asks, let's see here. That's an interesting question, Scap. You can ask me that in private. What's the difference between stitching and stapling the vocal cords? Are staples used with the vocal cords?
I've not ever seen anybody use them. Staples exist for use in the body.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think they would hold in place for, so I think I only know of people using sutures.
Someone asks, I've had a tracheal shave and for years I lost my upper range. I'm really sorry to hear that, Mia. I got most of it back, cool, but I still lost a couple notes. Is this a situation, is a situation like this contraindicated for a VFS?
Well, I mean, I guess it depends. So yeah, it's one you'd have to have kind of a discussion about. How important is it to get back those notes? Because you could go in with a feminization rhinoplasty and retighten and get back those notes. But what has been going on is that they got loosened and then they scar into place. And that scar contracts a bit and it has restored some certain percentage of the vocal range, but not all of it. So, you know, but if you go in and do a webbing, you're not going to get back any more of the upper range because you aren't retightening them. You're shortening them and you're cutting off the bottom. Where if you did a feminization laryngoplasty, you could not even cut off any vocal cord, just open it up and retighten it, and you could restore. You can restore a lost high range.
Okay, perfect. Oh, I'll also Clover wanted to clarify when we were talking about a vocalization cost for everything. It's not so much that, you know, healthy vocalization is bad for you, but just that always on some level, the tissue's being disturbed in some way. There's some mild irritation, even if it's not negligible to where it's bad. It's just there's always some physical cost to vocalization. And so someone asks, can muscle atrophy be permanent for voice stuff? I know as a trans person, atrophy can be permanent for certain muscles, but I don't know if that applies to the vocal folds.
That's what someone asked. I think there's two things that happen to vocal folds over time. One is if you don't use a lot, you do get muscle atrophy, and you also lose elasticity. So to the degree that you don't use a muscle very much and it atrophies, you can probably recover that. But the aging process and loss of elasticity, I'm not sure there's anything you can do to restore that tension or tightness.
That makes sense. Now, I have worked with some presbyphonic voices before and managed to get some decent success in sort of not, you know, de-aging the voice a little bit. There definitely seems to be an upper limit on that for sure, though. I'm actually looking forward to aging because I'm really curious to see if someone is going into aging with a very intentional focus on trying to prevent aging of the voice, how much I can fight nature. So I'm very curious to go through that. Someone says... can the metal be removed in a procedure after the laryngoplasty is healed? I don't know what metal you're talking about. I don't think.
Well, I do in the laryngoplasty, in feminization laryngoplasty. Afterwards, when I put it back together, I put a metal plate on.
Oh, okay, gotcha.
And then I tie the vocal cords to that to re-tension and pull the vocal cords back to the front where they belong. And that metal plate needs to be in there about a month. And by a month, your own scar tissue is taken over. And although I don't typically remove the plate, it can be removed after a month and it's not doing anything. It's like getting a facial fracture. You know, you break a bone, you put a plate in, it heals, then you can leave it in and not have another surgery, or you can have another surgery to take the plate out. It's not necessary.
Jessica Hawk says, I had a tracheal shave and I believe I lost access to all my falsetto and I miss it. Is there any option to return for my falsetto? So we talked about this quite a lot. Do you want to answer this?
Well, I'll add to it. The feminization laryngoplasty, I can get it back. And I think Dr. Kim has a technique for that as well, which is that when he puts a web in, if you just put a web in, it won't add much. But if you put the web in and you're technically good like he is, and you pull the front down lower and tension it, so there's probably at least two ways to recover from that problem.
Excellent.
And would they're you both say, surgical.
Go ahead, what were you saying?
They're both surgical ways. I don't know.
Yeah, and would you say if someone does have that experience of total loss of falsetto from tracheal shave, would you say that's the anterior commissure issue?
Yeah, detachment. Yeah, that's the main symptom of detachment, yes.
Okay, perfect. Good. Well, do we have any other questions, folks? Gosh, I really just want to say once again, on behalf of everyone in my community, like, we can't thank you enough. Your information is invaluable. The insight is fantastic. I can't wait to, you know, work with my editor and turn this into a sort of iconic voice education resource so that everyone can have a clear way to get access to this information. Is vocal sulcus treatable or always require surgery to fix?
It's very poorly treatable and surgery is not very successful. So sulcus is a problem that many laryngologists are working on and few, if any, have solved.
As someone with throat and health issues from the past smoking work conditions, is vocal surgery likely to cause problems? Or better yet, I'll expand on their question. What's the relationship between smoking and voice surgery?
Well, there's probably not a direct relationship with smoking alone, but people who are smokers and talk a lot, that is the tobacco smoke's going in, they're
irritating,
vibrating a lot, they get this fluid buildup underneath the vocal cords that lowers the pitch. Thus, smokers sound lower than other people. But smokers and talkers, smokers who are quiet don't generally get that, but smokers who can't shut up, just love to talk, generally will develop or can develop these smoker's polyps. They can be taken off with surgery. It helps to have quit smoking, because why would you take them off and then keep smoking and talking? I don't know, but
When you say smoker's polyps, are those different from regular polyps and nodules? Are they maybe positioned in a different place because of the different irritations, or is there a difference between your general nodules and polyps versus a smoker polyp as you described it?
It's a big difference. So a polyp occurs on the edge of the vocal cords where they're smacking together. So a polyp will be right on the very edge. And often it will be right in the smack dab center between the front and the back, because that's the part that is most, goes through the greatest excursion and traumatizes. So polyps are on the edge of the vibrating edge of the cord, and they're generally in the center of it. Smoker's polyps occur on the superior surface of the vocal cord, and they end up building up fluid all along the superior surface and stretching the skin out. So those polyps run the length of the vocal cord, and they can range from a very small amount, and then the pitch just drops maybe a semitone, to big things that hang off and flop around and make the voice extremely rough. They can be like an inch long and a half inch tall. They can be really
big. I was not aware that there was a sort of
big difference.
That's so cool. I appreciate that information. Someone says, wait, where was that at? I missed it. Can you answer the question I asked? I know you said you'd get to it later. Darvis, well, I forget what the question was. Sorry. I said I would answer it later. If you can ask it again, and I'll ask it. Let's see. I think we are about good. Jess, hi, I got a question. What's a breathy voice? Is that dangerous? No, not really. Although technically, certain patterns of being breathy could create more irritation on the way that you're producing sound. But generally speaking, a breathy voice is just, there's more gap. There's less sort of, there's less closure. Maybe the angle's slightly different and you'll get a leak of air during the process. Do you have anything you want to add to that?
No, it's turbulent airflow. It's white noise. If you're a physicist, it's, anything that creates a gap and allows turbulent airflow generates white noise.
Yeah, Natalie, that was answered earlier. Price range for feminization laryngoplasty. For Femlar, it's about $15,000, I think Dr. Thomas said. Some of the other procedures, maybe $8,000. Someone posted in chat around $4,000. I don't know what that's about. Yeah, good. Okay, Mariana, you can achieve. Yeah, Mariana, I've taken a decade to do it, but my range is impressive. You can achieve a high fem voice while maintaining a deep bass. You can only accomplish this by using the vocal folds as you want a lot. Yeah, I would definitely agree with that. Someone says, should I talk with my voice trained in public even though it's not that good yet? I personally think yes, definitely, because part of the process is behavioral avoidance. You have to, because if we think about the relationship between, the way I look at it is it's probabilities. What's the most probable behavior that your body's going to do on reflex? And at first what happens is, you know, maybe 99% of the time it's the masculine stuff coming out, and we have to sort of slowly add and chisel away at that probability occurring and reintroduce this other behavior. And so, yeah, I think even if your voice, you're not super comfortable with it or you're not super confident with it, if you're in a safe environment and you can practice it, I think you should, because I think that that will naturally do, and not only that, but as you move through your life and you experience more dynamic situations, you'll naturally settle in and find coordinations and patterns that you're not going to get if you're just do an exercise over and over or something. So I think I would recommend for someone who's training their voice to try and use it as much as they can, as long as it's comfortable and as long as you're in a safe environment. So Let's see. Oh, wait list. Someone said you never answered that. How long is your wait list?
I don't know the answer, but there is a wait list. It does take time to get to it. I think one of the issues which we didn't go over has been that insurance.
Oh yeah, I forgot kind about of, insurance.
Is kind of once WPATH got this to be thought of as a physical problem as opposed to a mental problem, mm-hmm. insurance started to cover it, but not every insurance jumped on board. Medicare said at one point in the last couple of years that the top and bottom surgery should be covered, but voice is still considered cosmetic. Mm-hmm. So my experience has been progressive West Coast companies have covered it.
Right.
Intel, people who are self-insured or whatever, Apple, Google, mm-hmm.
Starbucks. Have covered it.
Well, that's the Ooh. Next iteration. I'll tell you what, Starbucks covers it, and I just mm-hmm. recently said I won't take any Starbucks insurance.
What's the reason for that?
So Starbucks covers it in theory, but then they often don't pay. And so it sounds good, but I've been not paid enough that I won't take it now because they make it so many hoops and so much difficulty. So I think it sounds better than it is. But yeah, I'm glad they do it. They even have an outside company advocating for patients and trying to help things out. But I think they're having a lot of difficulty with the company they hired to do insurance.
Actually paying out. Yeah. So you're saying Starbucks owes you some money.
Well, I'm saying Starbucks won't owe me any money because I'm not going to do any of their surgery. And they're the first ones I've ever done that with. And they sounded progressive.
Yeah. That's the thing is like everyone's like, oh, just go get a part-time job at Starbucks. You'll get, you know, your $80,000 FFS paid off easy. Go do it. So I know people tend to get good coverage support for FFS. I don't know. I haven't heard a lot of FFS surgeons. I do talk to some FFS surgeons and I haven't heard a lot of people talk about not paying. So I wonder if they're just it's something different in that situation.
Well, it could be related to the underlying Medicare issue where Medicare says there isn't enough evidence that voice surgery helps people.
Okay.
And until they change it, then other insurances are typically can be more resistant. Some insurances are great. Starbucks just doesn't happen to be one.
Yeah.
But
Clara says, Dr. Thomas, you look great with the long hair. It's a lot different from your thumbnail pic. I agree. The long hair looks great. I saw it in your recent video. I was like, what? I love it. It's great.
COVID run wild. Yeah.
I love that. Well, I think we're about ready to wrap up. I think we've gotten right. Darvis's question. Okay, we'll take one more question. Darvis says, I think this is a nice question to end on. My question was, since you both work in different fields of voice modification, one of you being surgical, one of you being behavioral, do you expect these surgical and behavioral fields to help improve existing voice modification for trans and GNC people? I would say absolutely. That's why we're having this conversation.
That's why people go to a meeting and they have interaction and they learn from each other. I just was at a meeting, you know, you asked about who does what in the world. And I just was at a meeting in Berlin with surgeons from around the world, many of them who are pushing the limits on this kind of stuff, trying new ideas. Mm-hmm. Yeah. By interacting with each other, it leads to new ideas.
Yeah, I love this. And this is one of the things that I was most looking forward to with our interaction today is like, I like the ability to be able to talk about this topic with like a behavioral perspective coming from me and then a lived experience from me and then your rich knowledge of all the anatomical and surgical details. So,
I'll finish up the conversation by saying you do need to come back and just spend time with a camera in your nose.
Let's do it. Let's figure it out.
You do whatever you want and we'll answer the questions.
Yes, let's do it. I would love to. Thank you so much, Doctor. All right, everyone. I think we're going to wrap up. Oh, someone says, Dr. Thomas, would you be open to here's one more question. Sorry, before you go. So Clover is my colleague, my contemporary. We're always working on new systems and we teach classes together. And we're currently working on a public book. It's going to be an audio resource. It's going to be a webpage, an app. It's sort of an interactive resource for voice education on this topic, but we're also going to contact authors that we feel have really unique insights. And Clover asks, would you be open to writing a book chapter on this topic of surgical options? You know, obviously we compensate you and stuff. But yeah, would you be interested in something like
sure,
that?
sure. I've written several. I was part of the Clinics in North America chapter in there that you talked about. Yeah, it takes time, but it's a That's very awesome. Worthwhile effort to get information out. So yes.
Perfect. Thank you so much. And I'll be looking forward to seeing you in Portland. I've moved, but I'll be back on the West Coast soon, and I'll keep in touch with you. Okay. Thank you so much for being here, doctor. And thank you so much for sharing your knowledge so generously. And as always, let's do our best. And I hope you have a great rest of your day. Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Cheers.
Bye.
Yep. And I'll put you in the waiting room. Okay. And then let me fix the stream. Wow, everybody. Wasn't that amazing? Oh my gosh, we're so lucky to have such an insightful and well-rounded thinker in this topic talking with us. Unbelievable. I learned so much. I feel like my brain has expanded a bunch. One of the biggest things for me, takeaway-wise, and Clover, I don't know if you were listening to this, but I kind of grilled him on this a little bit. I asked, well, certainly there's like other muscles involved in like weight and pitch relationship than just the CTA and the TA. He said no. He was very calm. He said no. He said, the LCA, the PCA, the thyroarytenoid vocalis, and the cricothyroid, that's it. So, it seems pretty confidently that we could talk about weight in a way that's like more, I want to talk about it perceptual weight, but I want to talk about it as perceptual weight. But I mean, it seems like it's actually not really contentious for us now to claim like, hey, yeah, weight is controlled by the relationship between the thyrovocalis or thyroarytenoidism and the cricothyroid. We've had that intuition. I'm talking right to Clover right now. We've had that intuition, but obviously like biomechanical is weird and you don't want to make like far-reaching claims. But I was really surprised that he was like, nope, that's all it can be. So obviously airflow has some relationship there into it as well, but I really like that. That's very exciting stuff. Yeah, I mean, Sumi, I was thinking that too. But the issue with the biomechanics is there's so much nonlinear relationship. I would even argue, his description of pitch being controlled primarily by the thyrovocalis and the thyroarytenoid and the cricothyroid, I would say even that's like a simple model view, you know what I mean? Because there's so many nonlinear relationships and stuff. So I don't know, it was very, very fascinating. I learned so much today. My brain's just going. Thank you for your videos on Voice Feminization Z. Love your videos. They're helping you throughout your transition. Of course. I mean, isn't it time for Trans Voice Lessons to give an official TED Talk? I'd be honored. That'd be really, really cool. Yeah, totally. You see, that's what I think too, Chloe. I'm still not 100% sold. I don't know. I maybe had a functional biomechanical. Anyway, it's interesting. I'll have to continue thinking about that more. Yeah, a question a while back from Abigail was asked, like, what if like you feel like your voice is masculine, but you don't want to, go through your day with such a masculine voice? What I would recommend is start working on literally just trying to remind yourself to get higher in pitch at the very least. Like, even if your voice sounds more masculine, like, you'll probably get some alleviation from that deep masculine frustration, even if you don't have very good proficiency, if you start practicing and working on trying to speak fluidly and comfortably and freely at higher pitches. Obviously, that's missing a lot of the process. There's more that you'd want, but I think, like, generally speaking, someone can practice just trying to speak at a higher pitch in a comfortable way for a couple weeks, and they should be able to implement it if they commit to that. I mean, maybe even a week. If you really practice for a week speaking fluidly and freely at higher pitches, most likely you'd be able to maintain that or try to come back to that when you're speaking. So I would say that if you're very unconfident with where you are in your voice, but you also don't want to just talk in the masculine voice, you don't have to do anything crazy. Just try to go higher while you talk, and even if it's a little more androgynous, it's not necessarily feminine sounding all the way. Like, I think that that's still a more positive step than sort of kind of allowing it to kind of bask in the lower spaces there. Z, if the only goal is capable of producing, if the only goal is capable of producing a male sound and not a passing voice, I'm sorry, I don't understand that question. AOEU. Producing a male sound, are you talking about in the case of transmasculine? Well, so I guess it depends. Producing a male sound and not passing, I don't know what you mean by that. Because if you're a transmasculine person and you wanted a male sound, that would imply that you'd want a more passing sound, right? And if you're transfeminine, so I think there's a logical challenge there. Yeah, no problem, Abigail. I'm glad you asked that. Like, I know it's really frustrating and sluggish, but like, what'll happen is if you can start to get that pitch up and you can at least get that, like you're creating a more fertile ground for more intentional modification to happen later. Or let's say you ended up getting surgery or something, you know, that process of working towards the behavior you want and trying to avoid the behavior you don't, it's going to help across the thing. Okay, Mariana Shaw, the goal of end cable. Oh, did I misread that? Oh, I'm sorry. I misread that. So in terms of my recommendations for surgery, I talked about that with Dr. Thomas, and I love his insight on this about, you know, you have to ask what is the goal of the client? It's so important. If you like say, I never want to have those low notes ever again, and you're like, I've tried voice training, it's not so effective. Yeah, then it seems like if you understand the risks, that surgery might be a good option in that case. But, you know, that's something to talk about. Well, we talked about a bunch. Let's see. Is there a Discord server for Patreon backers? There is. I'll go ahead and let me go ahead and plug James Thomas's stuff. Everyone had questions about that. I should have did that before he left. I should have told him to plug his stuff. If you're listening out there, James Thomas, I'm sorry I didn't let you plug. I normally don't have guests on, so I'm not used to that. So I'll plug Dr. Thomas's stuff in chat. Here is his here's his website. There's a lot of information on there about voice in general. And then his YouTube is, I'll post his YouTube. He does have a pretty big YouTube and he has a lot of cool content on there about voice related stuff in case you're interested. It's Doc Vox. So here's his YouTube channel if you want to go and subscribe with him and support him and stuff. So there's his YouTube. And in terms of where he's at, I said it earlier, he's got good SEO. Yeah, totally. Me too. let's see here. Although I don't do anything for SEO. I just have a name that's very general. Now you have to make an apology video. Just to confirm what I was thinking. If I speak several languages on a daily basis, do I have to practice feminization of all of them sort of equally? Yeah, kind of, not really. Like generally speaking, the core principles are going to transfer to whatever language you're speaking in, but you might find that some languages have patterns and stylistic properties that make it easier or harder for you to maintain your feminine sound. You might also find that depending on your experience in those languages, the language you've spoken less in might be easier to feminize, or the language you've spoken more in might be easier to feminize. So there tends to be some imbalance there, but it depends. What the hell, he has 300 subs? Yeah, his top video has like 285 million views. Unbelievable. Yeah, it's the 11 years ago he put a video on YouTube of a stroboscopy and got 300 million views. That's crazy. But like I said, I mean, in my opinion, I certainly haven't talked and interacted with every vocal surgeon in the world, but I'd say you're pretty hard pressed to find someone who's got as much experience and wisdom as James Thomas. So it was really special having him here. I think the thumbnails on your channel are the hard carry in terms of the SEO. They stand out compared to is there anything major that you cover in your lessons that you don't cover in your videos? Yeah, well, okay, I love this talk. I love this question, Dexter. Yeah, but it's not intentional. Like, I don't selectively withhold information from people, you know, on my YouTube channel. But what happens is the model is always growing. My beliefs and philosophies and perspectives change every single day when I'm working on voice with people. And so it's less so that there's stuff that's withheld from my YouTube channel, and more like there's no way that my YouTube channel can follow the pace in which that I'm developing and Clover and I are growing our model and our theories and our philosophies. So it's not that there's intentional information withheld, but I would say there's a tremendous amount of information. There is way more information that is not on my YouTube channel than there isn't, if that makes sense. In fact, if I had to give a percentage, I've only made like 4-5% of the content that I feel is necessary in terms of videos for people to get the thing. Like for instance, all the Resonance channels, my perspectives on Resonance update and change every year. Even in the last 3 months, I've had a pretty pivotal shift in the way that I think about certain things. And so some of my older videos, they're not wrong, but they don't align with what I think and believe is the most optimal way to approach the education of a topic. So, it's really challenging. I have not yet, think about this, I have not even made a single video yet on articulation or prosody or pitch pitch contour, prosody, rhythm. I haven't made a video on any of that, but that's a huge component of voice, you know? And it's not because like, oh, we don't talk about those, or oh, they're not part of the discussion. It's just that, you know, you'll notice it's been 2 months since I released a YouTube video. There's gonna be one out tomorrow. But, you know, it's challenging to get the content pipeline set up in such a way that I can just dump content constantly. I'm trying to do that, and I really want to do that. It's been very challenging. So I'm really going to try to do better. I say that every time I come on here. But yeah, I mean, here's the thing, Disason, I'm going to make a general articulation video, but then I want to do an articulation video for like each main consonant class. Then I want to do an articulation video over like vowel modification stuff. Like there is a lot of, I mean, I could do a whole video on just theories of articulation in terms of the way that it influences. There's so many things. And, you know, I met with my editor and another helper that we collaborate with. And we did a video brainstorming night one night. And I mean, I've got like 50, 60, 70 video ideas. So it's not like there's like a shortage of video ideas. It's just, here's an example. I'm currently sitting on about 3 finished videos, totally done. My editor's in chat. They can back me on that. But I haven't released them because I have a tendency to like want to release things in a certain order. And it just so happens the way that what happened in the last 2 months, which is why I haven't released a video, is we had these videos that were done. And I was like, no, but I want to release this video first. So then, you know, all of a sudden it turned into a bigger thing and then it hasn't been released. So there's something going on with the content pipeline that I've got to figure out so that I can dump all this information better. Someone said, articulation would be really awesome. What was the outcome of the poll you did for VFS patient satisfaction? So that was only for chondrolaryngoplasty, which is the tracheal shave. And we did talk about some of those findings tonight. I'm going to do a whole video on that at some point, or maybe I will, you know, cut in when we're making this full video. But basically, a couple outcomes that are really important to keep in mind were about a third of the individuals out of 140 sample size, about 30% of them indicated some chronic or long-term vocal impairment following chondrolaryngoplasty. I want to clarify, that's not following voice feminization surgery. That's specifically following tracheal cartilage reduction, you know, the burring down of the, it's called chondrolaryngoplasty officially. But so tracheal shave tends to, at least in this sample size population, 30%, the actual 23% said yes, and then 10% said possibly but unsure. So about 33%, and then 67% said no long-term impairment. Some other really interesting findings that I think stand out from this as well, I'll pull this one up, and this is something that I had talked about and came up in our discussion with Dr. Thomas, was patient education. So let me show you this. I'll take a screenshot in case you all want this. So take a look at this. It'll go on my stream where the chat's at. So just look where the chat's at. Wait, maybe I can't make it small enough. Yeah, I can't make it small enough. Sorry. I can expand this for now. Hold on. Let me make this bigger. Okay, so check this out. This is this is like the most like important finding out of that sort of research that I asked people. Do you feel you were properly informed? And I said this with Dr. Thomas. Do you feel you were properly informed of the long-term vocal risks by your surgeon? 34% say yes. 30% say somewhat. 35% say no. Long-term vocal risk wasn't mentioned at all. That to me is the most startling thing that I found out of all of this. So let me get that out of the way now. Let's see. And then there was also some other really interesting stuff. Hold on. There we go. There we go. A little bit bigger chat now. English my fourth. Ooh, you guys can hear that? I haven't played today. Maybe I'll do a little bit of piano. Let's see here. Yeah, that right, Mia, that angers me. What about informed consent? I agree. Wait, is there a troll in chat? Is there a troll? I saw someone say something about my father and loving father. Indeed, I do have a very loving father. He's pretty much my best friend in the whole world. Oh, yeah. Sorry, transphobe. You can't get me with that one. I have an incredibly close relationship with my parent. My mother passed away, and I also had a good relationship with her. So, sorry about ya. I don't have any existential trauma in my childhood that made me trans or anything. I'm just trans. Sorry for your narrative, my friend. Okay, let's see. Is it normal for me if it's way easier for me to do a feminine voice when I speak quieter rather than louder? Yeah, that actually is normal. Yeah, don't do that though. Don't crutch on that, because if you crutch on that, you're running into a potential problem. So don't do that. How are you coping with a window AC as a musician? Lyra, I hate it more than anything in the whole world. You don't even understand. I almost never run it. I just sit here and melt all day long because I hate how loud it is. It's unbelievably loud. Hate it. When I had a conjugal laryngoplasty, they prompted me about damaging teeth and everything. Well, that's interesting. But did they mention the vocal concern though? It was so nice when your father wished us all Merry Christmas a few years back. Yeah, so everyone knows, every year we have a Christmas stream on this channel. It's my anniversary. It's tradition, and I will continue to keep it as a tradition because I love doing it. And that reminds me, I still need to mail something out from that stream. So if you're listening and I owe you something in the mail, I haven't forgotten. It's sitting over there. I just haven't mailed it because I haven't been at the post office. Okay. But yeah, so to get back to that main point there. So my dad always comes in and wishes everyone a happy Merry Christmas or whatever. And if you need some love, he's there for you. It's cute. Have you ever considered streaming a voice lesson like Healthy Gamer? I have, yeah, actually. The thing is it's mostly about consent for me. It's not about, you know, caginess or anything. There's been some people who have consented, so I would say that there is a reasonable chance that you might see some actual full lessons on here. Whether that's me live streaming it or whether that's like me like posting a lesson recording of, you know, a good interaction or whatever interaction, it just depends. Z Dad is absolutely precious and I love his twang. Yeah, you can hear my dad's voice like blocks away, right? Crying right now. Had a student the moment you all opened up for questions. Yeah, I would have loved to get some of those questions from you, Addy. Dr. Thomas is such a plethora of knowledge. I'm so excited that he literally cordially invited me to go to his office, stick a camera down my throat, and do research. Ah, that's so good. I can't wait. So yeah, I'm definitely going to follow up on that. There's a lot of, you know, we've done some camera, we've done some, you know, imaging of the voice feminization process. I think I have a video that I released 2 or 3 years ago on this channel, called like voice feminization inside, which is like with cameras and stuff. But you know, that was at the end of a vocal health checkup with Dr. Thomas. And so it was very brief. We only had like 2 minutes. I was like, let me do a couple techniques. And he's like, sure. And he got those. So the fact that I can go back there and we can maybe like actually take some time to be like, let's, you know, work. Let's see what happens when I change this feature. Let's see what happens when I change this feature. Let's see if we can see a relationship between these things. I'm really excited to tussle and see what we can figure out when we're playing with stuff like that. Christmas is my birthday, funnily enough. I suppose I'll have to make it to the stream this year. Yes, Skylar, we'd love to have you. The cam's amazing. The vocal cords are beautiful. Agreed. My vocal cords are so pretty. You know what I'm saying? They're so gorgeous. Would you recommend more voice lessons to improve the vocal range over surgery? Totally, Belle. I don't know if you heard what Dr. Thomas said, but he said vocal surgery will not give you more high end. That's really important. I didn't know that, actually. I mean, it makes sense, but I always thought that, you know, you reduce the vibe. But I guess that makes sense because it's vibrating length. He mentioned that the relationship between length to mass ends up being the same when you do the process. And so I guess that's possibly why the upper end doesn't change, but the low end changes. So yeah, Belle, if your goal is to improve your singing range, definitely not a surgical thing. He said with every vocal surgery, it will have reduced range, not increased range. So okay, same stream when I learned about tretinoin. There you go. Love that for you, Lauren. I'm so glad. Lauren, I love your comments. You're always so positive. It's great. I'm happy with my surgery results. Had it 3 weeks ago. Oh, that's so wonderful, mashed potatoes. Congrats on your result, and I'm glad that it was really helpful for you. Dysphoria is the biggest block in my training. Does anyone have things that work to minimize dysphoria while practicing? I plan to make a video on that. It came up during the sort of brainstorming with my editors and stuff. I've talked about this a lot, so I'll be honest, I don't feel like talking about it now, but I do intend to make a video, so I hope you don't feel like unheard. But in general, the ways I've talked about it or the way I've experienced it was either, you know, trying to reduce the process into absurdity, you know, distance yourself from your voice and not making voice about necessarily identity, but making it more about just like I'm making sounds. Some people have suggested disassociation. Some people have suggested thinking about it as a character voice. Some people might suggest practicing with noise or something else going on in the background, although I can't really love that recommendation. There's definitely no super one answer. Oh, I started answering your question, though, so I wouldn't. Sorry. Allergy season's killing me. What is a voice-healthy way to clear my throat? It depends on what your mucus is doing. You know, if your mucus is loose and you can clear it, and it's not too bad to do some regular old clearing. The key here is when you're clearing your throat, make sure you're not building up a tremendous amount of pressure, or you don't have too much. You're not absorbing too much of that built-up pressure into your vocal fold tissue. So you don't want, you know, nothing like that. That's crazy, right? Just short little bursts. You can do glottal fricatives. That's a pretty healthy way to try and clear your mucus. I would recommend singing if you feel you're all mucusy. Like, just start singing or humming. That's, if I feel super mucusy, that's like one of my favorite things. I just start singing because you're going to dislodge it possibly. Also, don't forget to hydrate. You can also do pressurized swallows. So there's a lot of different ways that you can deal with different mucus issues. Have you ever talked to a classical countertenor about their technique? No, but I mean, they're pretty much just singing in falsetto. That's very reinforced, very, very skilled. Ziana, has your opinion on surgery changed today? Well, I don't really think like, okay, so I always tell students, you know, I have a personal opinion on surgery and then a professional opinion. I would say that my professional opinion hasn't changed at all because my professional opinion has always been, you know, listen to the needs of the individual and determine if that's right for them. And, you know, if they're aware of the risks and the potential upsides and they have true informed consent, do whatever you want with your body. That's my professional view. My personal view on vocal surgery, I think it's cool. I really do. I think it's cool. I really, my reservation and caution around it is like, I've seen some people in our community treat it like it's like, oh yeah, I'm just gonna go get vocal. I don't think you should, if you're curious about vocal surgery, I don't think you should treat it like something that's willy-nilly, off the cuff, something real casual, go on a weekend. You know what I mean? It's a very serious surgery. And like Dr. Thomas said, there's a lot of possible risks, a lot of possible complications. And so you really have to evaluate if it's worth it for you. My professional opinion is informed consent is key. So as long as an individual understands what behavioral vocal therapy and vocal training can do and the upsides and downsides to that and the upsides and downsides to surgery, and then they know the risks of surgery, then I would of course never be like, oh, don't do that. No, you know, I think you should do whatever you want with your body. And that's honestly, if anything, after this discussion, I would say that my personal opinion on voice surgery and my professional opinion have actually merged more. My personal opinion on voice surgery previously was a little more personally, I was a little more critical of it. But I think it really comes down to surgeons. I've just heard a lot of bad results. I've worked with a lot of people with VFS, and most of them, at least obviously sample bias, because if they're coming for voice lessons, clearly they're not satisfied with their voice. So, you know, I don't get to see the cases of people who've had vocal surgery who are totally happy, but I have close friends in the community who have had vocal surgery, and their satisfaction, both of them, two of my really close friends, their satisfaction is somewhere in the middle. They're like, yeah, it helped, but they're like, but I still think I sound like I'm, you know, I still think I'm clocky or whatever. So their opinion's a little more neutral on the results they had. They had yeast on. I definitely think the quality of surgeon matters tremendously. I think that's true for every surgery. But I think in voice surgery especially, because the real problem is, at least with the results that I've seen with voice surgery, is you get some members of our community who get VFS done as like an add-on to FFS, right? They get a whole FFS, and then there's a facial plastic surgeon who's like, we could do a voice surgery too. And I just think, like, are you really a voice surgeon expert? I think if you're going to get vocal surgery, you should go to a voice surgeon, someone who day in and day out is dealing with the larynx. And that's not always the case, right? So I don't want to name anyone by names, but there's a lot of different surgeons that do vocal surgery. Yeah, so there's someone talking about some of them there. And I'm, like I said, so glad that that went great for you, mashed potatoes. But, you know, there's some cases where it doesn't pan out that way. So I think it just, yeah, just know the risks, know what you're getting yourself into, accept them when you go into it, and hopefully the person ends up with a less dysphoria, because that's ultimately the goal. So, yeah, Belle, we're working on something right now. Actually, I just paid the bill for it last night. The data storage stuff was overdue because my debit card expired. What's your opinion on DIY HRT when HRT can be acceptable? Are you really asking me that? I'm pro DIY. I know some people are like, oh my God, you're going to say that as a professional? Yeah. So what? I think trans people should be able to access HRT and they shouldn't get gatekept. So yeah, love the DIY thing. Now, I also think though, there is some irresponsible culture in DIY, but like that doesn't change my opinion on like doing DIY HRT. I just think, once again, know the risks, know the benefits, weigh it. It's your body autonomy. Do whatever you want with your body. Put whatever you want in your body. It has nothing to do with me. So naturally, I'm very in favor of, I mean, I personally think we should have sports leagues that are steroided out. You know, I think that this whole like thing of like, oh, well, like, do you know how hard it is for like cis men to get testosterone? Same with like trans men too, but with cis men too. Like, I think you should be able to put whatever you want in your body. I think you should be able to go and get whatever hormones you want, whatever body modifications you want. I'm very much like, transhumanist in that aspect. Like, do whatever you want with your body. And I think, in fact, we need more options of choice to do with our body. You know, like if someone out there wants to be a huge meatball and inject tons of testosterone, hell yeah, that's awesome. Do your thing. Know the risks, know the benefits, do it as safe as you can, and yeah, enjoy whatever you're doing. That's my general opinion on body modification in general. So yeah, Blurn's Ball from Futurama. Yeah, imagine how much more entertaining sports would be if everybody in the league was doping. You know, I mean, the thing is, a lot of them already are, but imagine how crazy that would be. Like, yeah, exactly, Mari. Like, screw it. Let's see how fast we can really run. Let's see how crazy this stuff can really get. You know, I'd love to see that. That'd be awesome. Yeah, it's plank. Yeah, it sounds scary. I don't think it sounds scary, but I definitely think like it shouldn't. I definitely don't think it should be like super casual. You know, I don't think you should be like, I don't know, I think I'm just going to take some HRT today. You know, like I think you should like be like, okay, I've thought about this for a little bit. Clearly, I want this. It'll be beneficial for me. I'm going to try this. And then you take it, right? I don't like, this is okay. And this, I don't care if this is controversial. I'm going to speak out about this. I don't really like the, like, how do I say this? I don't really like some of what I see in, like, egg culture. You know, I definitely like the memes. Oh, you're an egg. I get that. But I definitely don't like the idea of, like, oh, that person's kind of gender nonconforming. Like, let's call them an egg. You know, like, obviously, I think that helps some people. It helps them get a break out of their egg sooner so they can transition sooner. And no, I don't feel, you know, I don't think like as the conservatives think, oh, they're forcing everyone to transition is androgynous. But I do think that there's a little too casual with like telling someone you're trans. Like, I think, you know, that should maybe be something that they, you know, interrogate, think about, come, you know, it's a coming to terms with. I don't think other people can make that decision for you, and I think that if other people sort of project that on others, it's pretty irresponsible, because it is, you know, a big decision. And once again, it comes back to body autonomy. I just don't want anyone I want everyone to know what they're getting into. I think the problem with doping in sports is some people go out of the way to turn themselves into every non-human beings. Well, that's awesome. That's what I want, is non-human beings in sports. I think the problem with doping in that's not the problem with doping in sports, Simbar. The problem with doping in sports is that some people aren't doping and some people are, and so it's unfair, right? If everyone's doping, it's all free for all, you know? If no one's doping, then doping's cheating. So I think the reason why, you know, it's controversial is because people expect that sports are to be on a fair playing ground. You know, let's see here. Yeah, I definitely, yeah, for sure, Belle. I need to release faster, but I always get in this headset. I want to make it better. I want it to be better. I want it to be more useful. And then it often sort of gets cyclical. Who are some animators whose work you really appreciate and look up to? Onar Sentürk. Onar Sentürk comes to mind first. These are demo scene animators. Or they, I think he started in demo scene, but now he's, I like Gemini. I like, Team Andromeda. They're a demo scene team, that was doing generative visuals in like the early 2000s and late 90s and stuff. So I really like 3D animation stuff and whatnot. And, yeah. Okay, but if you're an egg, you scrambled, and sunny side up, an omelet? Be true to you. True. Agree with your controversial point. And I don't even think that should be controversial. You know what I mean? There's some things that I feel are, like, kind of common sense that, like, I'd get canceled for on Twitter. And they're not, like, crazy. They're just, like, really basic takes, you know? Like, people should be informed of what they're getting into or whatever. That's the crazy thing about Twitter. You can say anything. And, like, I saw a crazy post on Twitter today. Somebody was, like, talking about, like, oh, did you also know, I'm not even gonna get into it. It's one of those things where someone, like, says, like, one thing, and then the immediate reply is, like, the literal opposite interpretation of what they said, you know? And they're like, it's kind of like saying, like, oh, I love waffles. Oh my god, so you hate pancakes? You're so, it's like, not what was said. There's a lot of weirdness like that on the internet. I think sometimes people talk past each other, and it really stops our ability to engage in, like, meaningful conversations that make impacts. Release now, make the next one better. Thank you, Fiona. Any tips for implementing voice or after acquiring the range you want? Yeah, a couple. I've also talked about these a lot. So, you know, you need to have that consistency. You need to be able to return to it quickly. You should work on, you know, jump starting back into your voice. The ability for you to return to the target that you're after should be effortless, should be so easy, because then you're going to really need to consciously move around and inject that in your life as you're talking to people. There's some other things that I've talked about, but I mean, consistency is a huge part of that. It really is this brute force process of just trying to remind yourself to use what you're working on. There are some little shortcuts and little tricks and stuff and whatnot, but generally speaking, it's just brute behavior. Just do it a lot. Even if everything points to you being trans, cool, keep going. You may uncover something that evolves your self-understanding. I don't think you can just, you know? Or like this thing that's like, it's a meme, so it's not a serious thing, but you know, some people are like, oh, I like to do girl voices in D&D or an egg. I love that meme. I love that meme. It's hilarious. I love that meme. But, you know, I do think there are some people who just like to be able to do a girl voice because they like to be able to do a girl voice. You know, I don't think that having an interest in being able to do voice feminization necessarily indicates if someone's an egg. Although, of course, you're going to see a much higher overlap between people who are interested in voice for reasons they don't yet understand being eggs, you know. But I just think it's like, you know, gender nonconformity is great, and I don't think we have to classify every existence, you know. I think that's on the individual to do. Yeah, exactly, Pina. I think it's a good and bad thing. You know, it's got good influence and bad influence. I explained to a trans woman why a cat and a woman are the same thing. Oh, yeah, I know. They always say, oh, so you could just be anything. Well, sorry, there's not been any evidence that indicates that, you know, I could be a cat, actually. It doesn't really make sense for many reasons. And that's just a medical thing, not even counting the more, like, sociological surroundings of the topic. I had a lot, sounds like a few years ago. I'm hot and sweaty. I'm getting gross and disgusting. Ew, I think it's time to end the stream. We've been going for 3 hours. Very good stream. There's going to be a YouTube video out tomorrow. Watch it. Click back on. Don't forget to like this. Oh, hit like too. Hit like so the algorithm pushes it. So hit like. Don't forget to subscribe if you're new. It's great having everyone here. Yes, I see the likes going up. See, so many people were watching without liking. Like it. I'm watching. So yeah, I'll have a video out tomorrow. It's a full high, you know, it's a long form video. It's one of those like high quality ones. Spoilers for the video. Sure, I'll give you half spoilers. I think it might be the most important video I've made, only because it will act a lot like a Rosetta Stone for understanding how, you know, my older videos, newer videos, other people's videos, other things. I think it's just really important. Really important. So that's kind of why I took a bit of extra time with it. Plus also I just procrastinated for like a month. My editor Scap, I don't know if I'm supposed to say that, but my editor gave me the finished version like a month ago. And then I'm not gonna lie, I was working on it last night. I basically redid the entire video. There's a lot of parts from the original that I'm gonna keep, but I just got into it and I was like, you know what, I can do this even a better way. I'll do it this, I'll add this thing. Literally, there was already a 20-minute video that was edited and done, and then last night I literally made a brand new 9-minute video. And so now, then after last night, I you know, put them together and took the best and made it a better presentation overall. So time frame for the video release tomorrow. It'll probably be tomorrow at noon or tomorrow at 1 p.m. So it will be done tomorrow though. All right, folks. Oh, let me plug my stuff. You know, I got a pluggy plug. Of course, if you are interested in lessons or group lessons, I don't have a lot of single lesson availability, although, of course, you know, we're going to try to create a regular waiting list, but I add dates and they just disappear. So I don't have a lot of individual availability. Also, Clover's schedule is increasingly getting tighter. So I'm really happy to say that within the next month or two, or maybe even sooner, there will be a new teacher at Transvoice Lessons, someone I've been working with, and they're already an amazing vocalist, great proficiency. They have a vocal degree, education, whatever. They've been a choir director and vocal, whatever. They're awesome. And she is so skilled with her voice, and we've been working together, you know, trying to build up her confidence and teaching voice alteration and stuff like that. And, you know, she shadowed some lessons, and it's been a good process. But we are now going to have a new teacher, and she's awesome. And so there's that. And then if you're interested in group classes, those are available on the website, which I'll post in chat here. We're going to start doing more group classes. So right now we have one group class available starting in, I think, August or something, but we're going to try to have about 3 group classes available, staggering in the months that they start. And those group classes are always improving. And, you know, Clover and I manage those and work on those, always trying to make them better. So there's our website in case you want to check out that stuff. Like I said, Clover and I are kind of swamped with private lessons already. So group lessons, we welcome you. And then the Patreon, if you would like to join the Transvoice Lessons community, we do have a Discord. I've been a little less active on it lately just because I've been dealing with other stuff, mental health mostly. But if you want to support the community, there's tons of videos and lectures and extra information that's not on the YouTube channel there, just because it's like not as like polished. It's more like raw information. I tend to try to do events, although I haven't done an event in about a month and a half or so, just because, like I said, mental health. So I usually will try to do an event every now and then. We have different practice events. There's a weekly practice event. There's usually people hanging out in VC working on voice or just talking about stuff. And pretty active community. So yeah, if you want to join that, feel free to join via the Patreon. And then is your band broken up for good? Not really. We're not broken up. We're still friends. It's just a matter of time, you know. Logan's got his career, he's involved in all this stuff, and Joey's doing his media business and his filming and all this stuff, and we've all kind of went our own ways with our careers. And I think at some point, we always tease it every time we get back together. We're always like, what do you think, we get the old band out and hit the road, you know? But maybe when I have more time. I definitely want to try to finish this voice book that Clover and I are making, which is going to be a public resource and a website and interactive media and all this cool stuff that we're working on, although we're a bit behind on that, I'll just be frank with it. But you know, hopefully once that's done and some of the other more key information's out there, then I can start focusing on my music career again, because, you know, I plan to teach forever, and I like teaching this stuff and I love doing this, but I really continue to feel this strong impulse and calling to return to my music more. And I'm playing music constantly every day. And actually, I'm the best I've ever been at piano. I've been practicing piano like hours, at least an hour, two, three, four a day. And I'm starting to play really fast and really accurate, which I've never been able to do before. Like, I've always been like a slow player that kind of, ooh, spacey, rich chords and pretty harmonies and smoothness. But like, I'm really starting to get some piano chops, which is a long time coming. I've been playing piano for like a decade. So really excited about that. Would love to hear something new. I'll play a song before I go. It'll be in mono though. I figured out how to get it stereo though, so whenever I start to do music streams in the future, it's gonna be stereo. In fact, I might even be able to make this one stereo right now. No, I can't. I'd have to open my software. But here's a song that's kind of interesting. Wait, where is it? It's not done, but I think it's interesting. I don't even know if I'll finish it. I randomly wrote this in one night. Big hearts for everyone. I love that piano. Finish that, but it's gonna be this huge ladder. It's gonna be crazy. Wrote that one night randomly. I'll just be honest, I was like super stoned. I was like, I'm sober, by the way. I quit all drugs. I'm done. Today's my second day of sobriety. But yeah, so give me some second taste of sobriety. I'm gonna be sober. I think it has issues. I think it has to do with my motivation, productivity, focus. So I'm done. So sober life. But yeah, I was like super stoned one night and I wrote that in like 2 hours. It was like not a bad tune, actually. I was like, sounds kind of cool. Also, there's this thing here, which I think is really, really awesome. I created a new tuning. Let's see. Let me find it. This is an awesome tuning that I recently created. It's like a hyper pyth double comma whatever kind of tuning. And it sounds insane. Let me see if I can find it. Is this it? Yeah, listen, this is crazy. A solo piano piece in a really weird tuning. It's hard for you to figure out the pitch contour. Yeah, it's weird. Ooh, my favorite part. Listen to this part. At the end, this little release after all that boom dong ding dong dum ba, then this legato kind of. Oof, it just washes away. Done yet, but my goal with it was to make a solo piano piece which can actually be played on real piano, acoustic piano, but is this. And you know, it's easy for, because one of the problems with microtonal music is it's hard for your average musician to read because there's all these new symbols and stuff. But this, you could read it just like you're playing normal music. The sound is just going to be different. So I kind of like this because I like a lot of those kinds of things where, you know, where an average musician could just pick up the instrument and play what you've got on the page, but then it's just all these extra, you know. Ooh, I've been playing a lot of Irish folk song lately too, especially Loch Lomond. And I've been trying to work on really fast. I don't know if I can do it right now. Wait. Ooh, I'm not warmed up right now. Thank you. So it's music now. Might as well ask, is using a fretless string instrument good as a way to introduce myself to microtonal music in general? Yeah, I think so. It depends on the fretless instrument. It depends on the scale of the instrument. Smaller scale instruments that are fretless aren't really going to give you the resolution. I mean, they'll give you resolution because, you know, we live in a continuous non-discrete universe or whatever. I guess that's what quantum mechanics notices. But you're not going to get as much sensitivity to pitch if you have a smaller scale instrument. And by scale, I mean like the length of the neck pretty much. Fretless bass guitar, I would suggest cello. If you want a fretless instrument that's great for learning microtonality on, cello's great. Or a continuum, a Haken continuum like I've got over here, that's great. But you know, fretless guitars and bass are great too. I mean, if you want to explore microtonal sounds, I'd recommend just checking out, you know, a synthesizer that's on your computer that you can load microtonal sounds into. Or for instance, Scala, the program Scala, or Scale Workshop, playing music in there. Or even another one, which is what do they call it? Zen paper dot whatever. That's like a free application online where you can just put in microtonal stuff and listen to it. But it's a little more limited because it's a tracker based like programming type kind of thing. Are you talking about Dr. James Thomas? No, I'm talking about Dr. James Thomas in Portland. And in fact, we did a 2.5 hour interview or so, or 2 hour interview. So if you are curious about what we were talking about, you can always click back. The stream's pretty much over at this point. I'm just kind of playing a little bit of music and chilling. Bonus points to whoever can whoever knows what this sound is. I'll do it a different way. Or like this. Influence, musical influence as a kid. Well, I wasn't really a musician as a kid. I didn't really start music till I was 14, 15. I mean, you could maybe count that as like a kid. Obviously, I was a teenager. I didn't get into music till I was like 14, 15. Before that, I listened to a lot of hip hop, a lot of like gangster rap. That was what I kind of came up on. A lot of classic rock from my parents. Gangster rap from LimeWire. Then I got into more alternative music and rock music. And then after that, here's been my musical trajectory. So I wasn't such a musical kid, actually the opposite. I wasn't a natural at all. And everyone who grew up with me, who played with me knows that, all my old friends, and wasn't a musical natural at all. I just worked really, really hard to become proficient with music. And part of the thing for me with it, so I first heard like hip hop and like gangster rap, and then I got into like more alternative stuff. I got really into System of a Down when I was like 14 or 15, and some other like rock adjacent to System of a Down, that kind of like alternative, you know, new metal, new rock kind of sound. And then I found progressive metal and death metal and grindcore and you know, tech death, Necrophagist, Dr. Acula, you know, those kinds of artists when I was younger. And then I started a progressive metal band and played in metal bands all throughout my teen years. Musically, I was mostly just listening to metal all the time and rock. And then around when I was like 16, 17, I started getting really into audio production, or 15, maybe, the dates blur, but around there, it's all in my music timeline. But then I got really into electronic music because I was listening to a metal band and they they like mentioned the band, the artist BT. And oh, I found Telefon Tel Aviv. I don't know if you know who Telefon Tel Aviv is, but I heard Telefon Tel Aviv. I heard BT. I heard Brian Trifon from Trifonic. I heard these kind of like glitchy, down tempo, chill out EDM, or not EDM, sorry, IDM artists, Square Pusher, not so chill out, but Square Pusher. I really liked Venetian Snares. Actually, I have a very fond memory. One of my old best friends and I, we used to play World of Warcraft, and I was a tank and they were a DPS, and we would do two-person raids, and or two-person instances, and we would always put on Sezamar Madar from Venetian Snares. That was so influential on me. I think that was, and then Amon Tobin, very influential to me. Amon Tobin's very influential. BT's very influential. Brian Trifon's pretty influential. I wouldn't say as influential. I found him a bit later. Telefon Tel Aviv, huge. Flashbulb, pretty okay. I saw Flashbulb live. The album Leaf was a huge thing when I was it was a huge thing for me when I was younger. Album Leaf's amazing. I went and saw Album Leaf in Chicago. I did shrooms that night. I was the only time I've ever been to a concert on a psychedelic, and it was great. It was so great. Loved it. And everybody knew around me what was going on. They're just like, yeah, we'll keep you safe, just have fun. So that was cool. And then that would have been 2011 when I saw the Album Leaf. I saw Amon Tobin twice with the ISAM set. If anyone knows what Amon Tobin ISAM set is, unbelievable, incredible set, amazing, visionary work, incredible. And I was very fortunate to see ISAM twice live. That's the crazy, you know, the 40-foot visual 3D projected cube inside. Flashbulb was in YouTuber Ben Jordan. Yeah, absolutely. I was listening to him before he was Flashbulb. Just because I was into anything that was glitchy and electronic and, you know, and that kind of stuff. That was my like teen years. It was progressive metal and glitchy electronic music, and that's why, you know, if you listen to the metal band that someone was talking about, Lauren was talking about in chat earlier, our metal sound was basically progressive metal with glitchy electronics. It's kind of the route we took. What else? So there was that phase, and then towards the end of that electronic phase, it never really ended, but towards the end of that electronic phase, oh yeah, between the Buried and Me, Colors album, is that what it's called? Colors of that. I'm not like a BT BAM like super fan, but I've seen them live. Really love their music. Great artists. In terms of metal artists that I like, I'm gonna have to say Tesseract. I'm gonna have to say what's that one Australian band? Carnivool. I don't think they're so much metal. They're more like groove rock. Oh my God, Carnivool. They lay down a fat pocket. So does Tesseract. I like music that lays down fat pockets. But then ironically, in my own music, I only give fat pockets for like 16 bars at a time. And then the rest is like this like crazy weird stuff. But that's just how my brain writes. So yeah, Necrophagist, Tesseract, The Contortionist. They're local and we had played some shows with them or whatever. Contortionist is great. I love, sometimes every time I get extremely angry, like I'm in a very bad mood, like very, very bad mood, I put on the Contortionist Exoplanet album and I turn my monitors up so loud. Like I crank Exoplanet every single time I get irate. Like I very rarely get like really angry. But like on the tiny random chance that I get angry, you'll hear Exoplanet just like, just hear it blasting throughout my house. And just like, you know, let's see what else music. And so then after I got out of the electronic phase, or not out of it, but I pivoted, I discovered classical music. I got into music theory because I got into composition because I was into production and audio design, sound production, sound design. And then I got into electronic music, blah, blah, blah. So then Oh, I forgot about this. I had a massive post-rock phase. I even had a post-rock band called Heva. And, you know, I was a huge Sigur Rós fan. I still am. I don't listen to them much anymore, but I love Sigur Rós. Hammock is like the greatest ambient post-rock band ever, except for maybe Godspeed You Black Emperor. So I love ambient rock. I love post-rock, stuff like that. Yeah, and then so after I went through that phase, parachutes and something, or Parachutes. I think that's just the name of it. That's Jean-C's, or Jean-C's the singer from Sigur Rós, who's a producer, and Jean-C produced this smaller Icelandic group called Parachutes. I like them a lot. They're good, or they were good. I haven't listened to them. Ooh, anybody know this band? This is a crazy deep cut. I want to know if anyone knows this artist. I gotta remember their name. Anathalo. Anybody know Anathalo? Oh my god. What was going on with that band? Anathalo, like, so ahead of their time. Like, still to this day, I can't think of anything that sounds even remotely in the same ballpark as Anathalo. So I definitely recommend that. Floating Worlds, I think, is one of their songs, or one of their albums, excuse me. And then I think they have another one. I think they put out two or three albums and then they disbanded. But they were like a 14-piece band that would have, you know, craziest stuff going on. And they, oh, Jagga Jazzist, or maybe it's Jagga Jazzist, I'm not sure. They're a Swedish, they're a Norwegian, or not Scandinavian, like progressive jazz fusion electronic rock group. I love Jagga Jazzist. I grew up listening to them in my teen years. I love Banflor. I love that album. It's incredible. I love the Animal Chin album. I love music so much. Every artist that's ever really touched me or really ever impacted me, like, I could just gush about them. I tend to not really, like, post my metal band very much, just because, you know, you can easily get my dead name and my dead identity. And of course, I don't mind giving it to people if I trust that they're not going to intentionally try and use it against me or whatever. But I tend to not, like, go around and be like, oh, just check out my metal band. So if you find it, you find it. If you ask me in private, I'll probably give it to you. But in terms of public, I've shared it a little bit on stream. I go back and forth. I don't know. It's a weird thing there for me because it was all pre-transition. Let's see here. Other. So then after I got into that, like, ambient post-rock vibe or whatever, and that energy, and that was the Jagga Jazzist kind of thing, then I got into classical music. I got into my first piece that ever really spoke to me in terms of classical music was Ravel's String Quartet in F. I heard that, my life changed. I would not be anywhere close to the same path that I am now. And then, of course, I got into the basic composers then and studied music theory and music composition and studied music history. So I like a lot of music throughout history. Love Josquin Dupré. I love William Machaut. I love some of that early chant stuff. Hildegard von Bingen slaps, which, by the way, is an amazing early female composer, if you don't know about her. Maybe one of the earliest recorded female composers that is, like, really remembered in the canon. So definitely check out Hildegard von Bingen. And it's amazing because she, you know, she really brought to the forefront some of these techniques that we see later. Of course, it was a collaborative effort for everyone involved. So yeah, that's, like, my early music tastes. I'm not a huge fan of Baroque music. I do like Baroque music, good Baroque music. Something that's, like, I kind of am more a fan of the Infantenkompfestil styles, which is this transitional period between Baroque music and classical music. So from the transition to the Baroque period to the classical period, there are sort of two main musical styles that tend to dominate Western practice, and that is Infantenkompfestil or Infantenkammerskite, or Infantenkammerskite, the emotional style, and then the Gallant style. And the Gallant style, Neo-Gallant, is ultimately what sort of became what we understand as the capital C classical style. So I'm a big fan of the Infantenkompfestil style stuff. I forget, the PCE Bach, or no, one of Bach's children was a Infantenkompfestil writer. Beautiful music, very ahead of his time. Zarlino, I love Zarlino. He didn't really write a lot of music, but I love his theories. Rameau was crazy ahead of his time. His timbral usage in the orchestra was just unbelievable. Probably because of his understanding of harmony, personally. You know, he wrote the Treatise on Harmony, which is one of the most referred to, you know, harmony theory texts that there is, period. It's pretty much the text that's primarily credited with creating tonal harmony in a way that we know it. Like, obviously it existed, but he really codified the bottom-up approach towards tonal harmony. So yeah, now we're at, like, 1780s, we're like 1720s now, or 1730s, 1750s, 1800s. Oh god, so there's so much good music from the 1800s. Obviously Beethoven's great, but everyone knows Beethoven. I was always a big fan of Schubert, Schumann, those classics, the classical romantics. big Chopin fan. I was a Chopin. I would say I'm a bit of a Chopin scholar, actually. I did read quite a lot on Chopin, and I wrote a bit on Chopin. I love late Romanticism. Around the 1860s, the 1890s is where stuff starts getting really, really interesting. The Mahler-type beats, the Mendelssohn-type beats, Wagner. I'm a huge Wagner fan. I know he's controversial, but I'm kind of a believer in separate art from artist. Like, I can do that. I don't mind. It's his time, you know. Sure, he was kind of anti-Semitic, but everyone in Germany was in 1870. So I really love Wagner's music. Beautiful stuff, incredible melody, incredible harmony, incredible texture. Just, I've been very influenced by Wagner, the Wagnerian philosophy of Gesamtkunstwerk, or complete and total work of art. I was about to talk about Rachmaninoff. We're not quite to Rachmaninoff yet. We got about 30 or 40 more years till he's really scooping on the scene. But I love Rachmaninoff. In fact, Rachmaninoff's, all three of his piano concertos, I would loop them when I would write term papers in college. So, and I still, to this day, like when I was working on my journal article that recently got published, I was listening to Rachmaninoff the entire time. All three piano concertos from start to finish, back to back, looping. I can sing every single note of all of his piano concertos. I haven't listened to a lot of his works outside of that. I've listened to some, but for me, his piano concertos are just amazing. Huge Debussy fan, huge Ravel fan. And that's just, so we haven't even scratched, I don't know, anyways, I'm rambling. But so yeah, that's kind of my musical development. I went from like rap into rock, into metal, into like extremely heavy death metal and complex progressive music. Then I got into electronic music and audio production, and then a lot of different electronic music. Then I got into post-rock, ambient music, experimental noise, really glitchy, crazy stuff. Then I got really into classical music because I was studying it a bunch then. Yeah, Impressionism is like my favorite movement, at least musically. And I would consider myself a hyper modern impressionist. I mean, I have this piece, Eurebia. If you listen to Eurebia, like, tell me the difference between that and impressionist music. Very similar. It's obviously more modern, my own vibe. I feel like Zen harmonic music is an extension of impressionism. I don't disagree with you. I definitely don't want to be like, oh, I can claim that strongly, but you know, the thing is, Ravel and Debussy were both so acutely aware of how timbre and harmony interact. And I really think that, to me, that's the essence of microtonality, is it's how can we manipulate pitch in order to generate timbre and relationships that aren't possible otherwise. And, you know, you see a lot of those Debussy 13 style chords, these kind of, you know, these, the Debussy sound is very much this kind of, you hear these big fat dominant nine chords. And so I tend to think, I tend to think that a lot of the chords that Debussy was writing or Ravel were writing, they were imitating certain harmonic series chords, but they just didn't have the extra notes. Just got home from work, caught a bit of the interview. We in the micro sauce now. Yeah, we're vibing. Yeah, Ravel was like, that's what's weird to me, is Ravel was the first composer to really speak to me, you know, where I was like, wait a second, I get what composition is now, right? Like, there's a difference between songwriting and composition, and that's not qualitative, by the way, that, you know, or how do I say it? That's not val. It's not a value judgment. You know, I don't think like, oh, a composer is better than song. But there's a big difference between being a composer and being a songwriter. Composers can be songwriters and songwriters can be composers. But if I'm entering a piece, it's like, if I'm planning on doing songwriting, very different mindset than if I'm doing composing. You know, I mean, it's not really that consciously different of a mindset, but they're very different processes. And, you know, being exposed to Ravel's music was like, I had heard music all up until then, which was composed by like producers and, you know, musicians, some composers, some songwriters. And I was instantly like, okay, there's something else going on here with Ravel. That's like something, there's something else happening. And that really launched my interest in music theory, because I needed to know how Ravel was doing what he was doing. I heard that, like, I heard this, I'll play a little bar of it. This, I used to sit around. Oops, let me move this there. Okay. I used to sit around after after school, high school. This was between me being high school and entering college. I used to sit around and I would listen to this. I would listen to this piece on repeat, but not all of it, just like the first couple bars. I've listened to the first like 17, 18 bars of this piece more than you would ever imagine. Maybe you'll recognize this piece. Oh, they're gonna play it. Okay, here we go. I love this, the opening. I love this. Now you bring it down. Then you bring it back. Bring it down. Boom, boom. That pizzicato. Ugh. Why did Ravel put that there? Just two little pizzicatos. Oh, I just got chills. I literally got goosebumps. Listen to that. Oh, they're right there. Oh. Right here, this is a little pizzicato, so subtle. Boom. Boom. It's so subtle, oh my god. I love it. I love Webern too. Don't get me started on Webern. And this is a little sultry little. Oof. Look at that cello line. I just love it. It just adds the spice. It's just so. Right here. What a beautiful. Like a Phrygian dominant thing or something like that. You know what, Tomas, this is an unusually good performance of this. I agree. This is the best performance of it I've ever heard in my life. You're not normally into classical. Okay, here we go. Every time someone says this, I have to do this. So when people say I'm not into classical, well, you haven't heard the right stuff, because classical music is a giant bundle. And I've yet to find a single person who can listen to the Daphnis et Chloe Suite number 2 and walk away feeling unimpressed by this piece. I'll just play a little bit of it. I would recommend everyone who doesn't know anything about classical music or have never experienced it to listen to this piece. This is Ravel's Daphnis et Chloe. Oh my god. What piece was that and what performance was that? That was what we were just listening to was the String Quartet in F by Maurice Ravel, and it was performed by the Hagen Quartet. Which they're so spectacular interpreters of Ravel. This is, I wish I could play all this for you. I mean, this is just the orchestration, most impeccable. Building. Listen to the winds. Anyways, you should all listen to that piece. It's amazing. It is, I always say this to my composition students. I tell them to listen to this and watch it and listen to it with a score, because this is a orchestration masterwork. The entire, I mean, all of Ravel's work that he did was just a textbook on orchestration. But this piece in particular, the way the winds speak, the way the strings and the winds balance, the way the brass balances, and the winds are so dynamic and active and agile and light, and just they blend in such a way, compositionally, the way he wrote it and arranged it, that it's just, it's unbelievable. Each instrument speaks and contributes its own identity. When the identities need to blend and disappear and become a 2D, not 2D, 2T, in case you're not a musician, a 2T homogenous type structure, like it's just blend. The percussion, he also has a double choir. It's like a 120 person choir or something here at the end. Where it's like, that's the end though. I don't want to spoil it, but that's like 20 minutes in. Hi, I seem to have dropped in during Ravel hour. You got it. That's right. Sounds are music to some of us. Yeah, I just love sound in general. Obviously, I love music very much, but for me, it's just sound in general. Just the thing that it even exists, the fact I can even feel it. And a lot of people, for me, it's the sensory experience that I love of it, you know? And I think that everyone does, but it's not so apparent for some people, right? Like, a lot of people don't even necessarily, haven't made the, like, conscious recognition that you have a sensory experience when you experience sound. I mean, that's obviously, yeah, you're listening to it, duh. But I mean, it itself is a sensation contained within its own. And it's the sensation of experiencing sound that I love, you know? Not even so much necessarily it's crazy. I love it. So cool. It's pretty clear who One Winged Angel was copy. Yeah, true. Okay. Well, folks, I think it's time for me to go. Oh, yes, the Mephisto Waltz is always a classic one. It's fun. I'm so hot and sweaty. I'm hungry. Okay. Is there an auditory equivalent of a gander? Oh, I know who you are. Yes, I saw your, I saw your message last night. A hearkening. I learned it. I'm not sure if I accept it, though, but it is hearkening. A gander, because you see, this came up with a student the other day. I had mentioned during a lesson that I wish there was an auditory equivalent to gander, because I'm always like saying, I'd like to, let me send that audio, send your voice over, I'll take a gander at it. And it always feels out of context because it's about the sound. So what is the auditory equivalent of gander? And it appears to be hearken. So I'm good. I'll give that a hearkening, which I think is kind of cool. Any Xenakis fans, don't get me started. I love, what's that piece called? Rebons. You know Rebons? I had one of my best friends in college. I won't say best friend. Good friend. Close friend. Especially at that time. We're not really friends anymore, but I hope them obviously the best. But they were like, they had worked on Rebons for like a year. I got so into Rebons, and I listened to some of those performances of Rebons are just wow. I love Xenakis. He's so good. I was actually talking to someone recently who studied with him. It was kind of cool. It was cool. Xenakis taught at IU for a while, for a couple years. I think he was out by the 90s, though. Hi, Zia. These months I really hated music, playing because of bad things happening all around me, because of my gender dysphoria and all the stuff of it. I discovered your work on YouTube and very recently fell in love very quick. Now I have the will to play again. Oh, that means so much. I am so glad to hear that. I am kind of a musical radicalist in many senses, in that I believe everyone should be musical, and I believe everyone is musical in some capacity, because musicality is really the spontaneity of existence combined with sound. And I think that music and creation and music, a lot of people are like, oh, well, I'm not a musician. Like, you don't have to, you know, perform. You don't have to be a crazy musician. You don't have to be a professional. You can just be a person who likes to play, to make the sound, to be around music, to hear the thing, to, you know, it doesn't have to be anything. There doesn't have to be a purpose for you making music. You don't have to go into it for money or go into it for fame or go into it because, you know, it's like, oh, I have to make this album. It's just the love of sound and the love of creating and participating in sound generation is beautiful. I love hearkening your content. Oh, thanks. Favorite instrument in the orchestra? I'm gonna have to say cello or horn. I do love a good horn. I do love a good cello. I do love a good timpani, although they're obviously a bit more limited. All right, folks, it's time to wrap up. Amazing stream today. I'm so glad we were all here. Special thanks again to Dr. James Thomas for having this incredible conversation with me. I feel like we all learned so much today. Yeah, I'm going to try to have more guests. If you like this kind of format, like me bringing on individuals who sort of give interesting insight, I was thinking maybe I could interview an FFS surgeon, because I'm actually quite decently connected with FFS surgeons. So I absolutely could get Keo Jampa on here. I could probably get Regina Rodman on here. I could probably get a different voice surgeon on here too if we want a different opinion, but I think James Thomas is kind of the best in my opinion. So yeah, if anyone has any other ideas of people who they'd like to, you know, hear me talk with or do stuff with, feel free to suggest that you know, in the Discord server, or tag me on Twitter or DM me on Twitter. Is there anyone you like to shout out? Clover, my mom, my dad, rest in peace mom, my brother, Kawa, Artosis, Tasteless, C9 Mango. No, I'm joking. Okay, I just did that because I know there's melee heads in chat. Yeah. Who was my FFS surgeon? Dr. Keo Jampa. I have a great relationship with him. Actually, I was just talking to him the other day. Literally like 3 days ago. So, mango. All right, folks, it's donezo time. Great stream, great being here. New YouTube video out tomorrow. You better watch it. You better like it. You better subscribe. Let's get it. Okay, bye, everyone. It was really fun today. I hope you're all really well, okay? And you have a great day, and you're all beautiful and lovely, and yeah, until next time, okay?